WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
It's the Wake Up Call with KB and Andy on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
It's electric, and it feels probably 75, 80% Purdue fans. But as Coach Painter always says, right, players got to give the crowd something to cheer about.
Lawyer, feed it. Edie, miss it.
Major highlight from Heidi.
Spin Newton, seven to shoot. Double from Colvin, it leaves Caravan open.
Bingo. What a find by Newton.
Hey, Rav, you make a mistake, they make you pay.
Edie with a left hand, left it short. Left it short, trying to score over Caravan on a left-handed hook shot. It's rebounded by Connecticut. We're down to 4:10 remaining in the game.
Oh, that's one. Zach definitely wants back.
Time quickly running out on the Boilermakers.
UConn fans on their feet behind head coach Dan Hurley. Shot clock down to four. Caravan, floated, clinging, exclamation point.
It's been that kind of night for Purdue's perimeter shooting. Braden Smith will get a cheer from the Purdue crowd, and so will Zach Edey. As Zach Edey gets a hero's applause as he goes to the bench area.
It is a UConn coronation. The Huskies make history. Back-to-back national champions.
The real difference ended up being their ability to offensive rebound in the second half.
Yeah, they just did a really good job guarding the three, and we got in the paint plenty of times. We just didn't convert on a lot of them.
You can say whatever you want about me. You can say however I play. You can say whatever, but you can never say that I didn't give it my 100% every single time I stepped on the floor.
We put ourselves in a great position now, and we took advantage of it. We just came up a little bit short to a great team. But I told our guys in the locker room, like, you know, when you have the most wins in school history, you're the first team to win back-to-back championships by multiple games since 1976, which was the last undefeated team in college basketball, and you get, you know, an eyelash away from winning it all, like that, you know, that's the standard.
I know I tried, it all fell apart. What it meant to be will eventually be a
memory. How the hell did Seton Hall beat UConn by 15? How the hell did UConn lose three games past season?
Creighton almost beat them by 20.
Butler was super competitive with UConn twice this year. Pretty darn incredible. It's a cheat code. The UConn Huskies, Dan Hurley's quote is cocky as hell, and it is spot on. We make a hard tournament look really easy, and they did it to the second-best team in college basketball. Last night, the Purdue Boilermakers, in one of the more just head-scratching performances you'll see, given the fact that the three-point line has been such a weapon for them all season long. I don't know if UConn had an eclipse around the three-point line, but they seemed to do that. Just absolute suffocation of the perimeter. Lived with Zach Edey doing really what Zach Edey does, but no threes. That was the game plan executed absolutely beautifully for UConn. Good Tuesday morning to you. I'm Kevin Bowen, Andy Sweeney. And Mark Dykton, as always, Rick Carlisle going to join us here like he does every Tuesday morning, 8 o'clock, as the Pacers are, ironically enough, for Zach Edey, north of the border tonight against the Raptors. To me, Andy, just boil it down to that. I mean, unbelievable by Danny Hurley just to be so committed to letting Zach Edey go one-on-one. We're not going to help when Klingon's on the floor. Twos are not threes. We'll live with it. We'll live with it. We'll live with it. And that's what, to me, it just all boiled down to. Sure, the offensive rebounds, as he points out as well, but still, 1 of 7 from the three-point line. It's just an astonishing, very foreign number, both of those numbers, for Purdue, really, all season long.
Yeah, good morning to you guys. I'm interested today, as we sit here, the psyche of the Purdue fan. You know, you go into last night, you're trying to have confidence. You know, Edey is better than Klingon, and you know that, and you're like, okay, if we can dominate that side or that position, if you will, on the floor, maybe get some foul trouble. You never thought you would be that destitute, right, from the three-point line. So, you know, I'm stuck as we go today. You know, KB, I'm stuck between, you know, Matt Painter learned so much last year and the last few years about how he needed to change things. He needed to alter things. I don't know if you're the college basketball world and you're Purdue, for instance, and I know Zach Edey's gone and the team will be different as, you know, players move along. You look at what UConn is doing. What are the lessons you can learn? You know, if you're Matt Painter, I wonder when he goes back with his coaching staff, hey, you know, last year we lost early. We weren't athletic enough. We didn't shoot the three enough. You go out, you get a guy like Lance Jones, middle part of the season. Guys like Cam Heidi, by the way, his dunk, easily the highlight of the night for Purdue. He goes up and gets it, and so he altered things. Now, you know, you look at how great UConn is, but, boy, I thought last night, whether it be everybody outside of Edey and Braden Smith, just absolutely no-showed. I thought the body language by Purdue wasn't great when they realized, wow, we can't stop these guys, and these guys are doing a pretty damn good job of stopping us as well. So it's been a magical season, but it didn't have a magical ending.
Yeah, I mean, that's certainly true. Nothing close to magical at all last night. I thought a couple things stood out to me game-wise. Certainly the first 12, 14 minutes. I mean, haymakers thrown both ways.
As good of a game as we've had.
Just an outstanding start. Edey was incredible. I thought the shot-making from Edey, like, he was making tough, tough shots. And I thought Bill Rafferty pointed it out so well. When Edey traveled there just, I think it was about 6:50, 7 minutes to go in the first half, he clearly was tired. And they hit a media timeout, and Caleb first goes in the game, and Donovan Klingon gets an and-one. And then on the other end, I think it might have been Trey Kaufman-Wren commits an offensive foul. And Edey is sat for 30 seconds,
yeah.
And Matt Painter can't sit him anymore.
No, he couldn't.
So he's back in the game, but that sequence right there, an Edey travel, an and one from Klingon with Edey on the bench, and then an offensive foul, it's just like the door gets cracked open for UConn, and then all of a sudden I just felt like the game tilted towards UConn. And even though Braden Smith hits, you know, the fadeaway three, it cuts it to two, you know, UConn gets a couple baskets there right before halftime, you just felt like, when that little sliver of hope all of a sudden allowed UConn to assert themselves, it was swimming upstream the rest of the way. And I'll do this a lot, I think, throughout the show, but I just cannot get over the lack of three-point attempts. And I don't say it, Andy, in that Purdue passed up great looks. I mean, they shot 7 threes. I believe I have this right. I think it's the fewest three-point attempts a Purdue team has had in 10 years.
Yeah, it's Indiana-like. It's Mike Woodson.
1 of 7.
Yeah.
So the one make is obviously a season low. Historically, CBS threw this up there late in the telecast last night. It's the fewest three-point attempts in a title game since 95, back when maybe the three-point line wasn't used as much as teams utilize it nowadays. And again, I don't feel like this was a bunch of, well, no, Braden Smith, shoot that. Lance Jones, usually you have like a neon green light. Why are you passing that up? I mean, they just didn't get any clean looks whatsoever. UConn just absolutely suffocating. I said to you yesterday, my one like big worry I didn't give much attention to last week that I was reminded of in watching UConn Saturday night is, man, those guards can really defend. And they're big and they're long. And I just thought they ate Purdue up on the perimeter. And that was the difference. I mean, if you play out Purdue's averages from three, 8 of 20, that's Purdue's average as a lethal 3-point shooting team. I mean, if you want to play the math, I mean, right there is what? 1 3 versus 8, that's 21 points. That obviously makes a huge difference.
It's a big difference
in
right?
the game. And you didn't offset it with the free throw line. You know, there's been games this year where Purdue's only made, what, 4 or 5 threes. But they can offset it when they hit 20-some free throws. But when Klingon doesn't get that second foul in the first half, you don't live in the bonus as much as you have in previous games. Boy, unless that backup center would have got another 15 minutes for UConn and could have fouled Edey on every trip down the floor, you just weren't going to make up for it. So if you want to boil it down to the game itself, to me, it was just the absolute suffocation of Purdue behind the arc.
I don't know if you saw this, but Draymond Green, I'm blanking on the kid's name that fouled out, Sampson.
5 minutes,
yeah,
correct?
Draymond Green said, you really helped break Edey down. I'm like, everyone's like, bro, chill, man. Dude played 5 minutes and fouled out. He caught a couple lobs, but that had nothing to do with the general outcome of the game. You know, I hate doing this to Purdue fans. I thought last night, to be quite honest, KB, I thought it was worst-case scenario. I thought it was worst-case scenario because It's the second game in a row outside of Zach Edey, where we leave not thinking too much about their offense. You said that, I think, yesterday, that offensively, the NC State game, there wasn't a ton to take away other than that the Jones and Lawyer went to bed on Saturday night, Sunday morning, feeling pretty damn good about themselves. And obviously, and I was wrong, you were wrong on this particular item, that did not care. That had no carryover whatsoever. And it was worst case scenario because, you know, they allowed Edey to get his. And Edey talked about this after the game, that even as great as his numbers were and as good as he was at times during the game, you mentioned where he got tired there in the first half. There were lulls. And I swear to you, it was the first time that we saw Edey kind of have bad body language and be tired. So if you're a Purdue guy, okay, and when I say it's worst case scenario, it's Edey's getting his and it doesn't matter. It's Edey looks tired for, in my estimation, you know, the first time that I could really remember him being tired to where, you know, the announcers are saying he's got to get out of the game. And Matt Painter had to go to Caleb First, who just could not play in this game whatsoever. And then, you know, Braden Smith was fine. He had 12 points, didn't shoot the ball well, back-to-back games. And then your guards just, A, they couldn't guard UConn's guards, and UConn's guards made it sure that all those shots, all those threes, all those good looks that we are so very accustomed to Purdue getting, they didn't get. And then, you know, you go to the bench. There's nothing. You know, Matt Painter tried to go to the bench. There was nothing on the bench. So you're not hitting threes. You're not getting to the free throw line. Edey, while being great, is compromised. And then the guard play, I'm sorry to Purdue fans, it looked like another level. And that's why, you know, last night you needed to knock down threes. You needed to get to the line. You needed a couple guys. You needed probably at least one of those guards along with Klingon to get in foul trouble. The foul line has saved them so very often this season, and it didn't last night. It was worst case scenario. They had no, you know, they jumped out of an airplane and the parachute didn't work over and over again.
Give major credit to Dan Hurley, who, you know, says to Tracy Wolfson there early on as Edey is looking like Shaq, like, wow, we're going to have to do some things differently. I mean, he was very blunt and very honest. And really, when Klingon was on the floor, they didn't do anything differently. I mean, he stood to that game plan of, when Klingon is out there, we're going to live with the twos. And we know Donovan Klingon can make it at least somewhat tough on Edey, and he will wear him down eventually. And again, not getting Klingon's second foul. I mean, you saw Klingon get real foul happy there in the second half.
Yep.
Like, there's precedent for that, but there was that moment there, I think 9 or 10 minutes, where I thought Klingon could have been called for a second, and they didn't call it. And it's just one of those things where, again, you have to be so damn perfect against UConn. And the game plan obviously switches when Klingon goes off the floor, because then the other kid gets in the game, and he certainly absolutely cannot stay on the floor whatsoever. But yes, just a terrible night from Purdue's others, really. I thought Braden Smith had a nice bounce back game. I know, you know, you can look at the shooting numbers, but I thought he quarterbacked it pretty well. But just to get nothing from Lawyer, nothing from Lance Jones, nothing from Gillis. Like, you got it. And those guys gave you something Saturday night.
I know.
I think that's what is extra frustrating. It's not, this is not Butler, UConn. Butler's in a dome and they can't throw it in the ocean. No, you shot it really well Saturday night. And yet you didn't even get any hope from behind the arc. And as I tweeted out at the final horn last night, it's the greatest 2-year run in my lifetime in college basketball. What UConn has just completed to go 12 of 12. In these tournament games, to cover all of them, to win all of them by at least 13 points, to have significant roster turnover. That's different than UNLV and Duke in the early 90s. That's different than Florida in 06 and 07. To have done that, and really it's not like they just totally revamped it portal-wise from last year to this year.
That's not the case at all.
It is wildly impressive. Dan Hurley is psychotic. But, man, can he coach? I mean, I told you guys
Purdue had to beat them because of Dan Hurley's antics. And, boy, he was full of them last night, wasn't he?
plus one. I don't know if I've seen the two-hand shove to a player before.
With 5 minutes to go, 4 minutes to
exactly,
go in the game.
With them leading by whatever it was, 17. A dozen or 15 at that point. They trailed for
six minutes
of a 240-minute tournament. Like, it's just, it's absurd what UConn now has done in back-to-back years. And I think just to kind of put a little bow tie Purdue-wise, the opportunity is not a given. You know, the opportunity is not a given. Now, Purdue had unbelievable health all year long. The same starting lineup for the entire season. That's never happened in school history. They didn't have the Haas elbow, the Hummel ACL. Hell, they didn't have the Jamal Shedd turn of an ankle in the Sweet 16. And now Houston is done. And obviously you're going to lose a generational talent. Now, you know, Purdue made, what, two Sweet 16s and Elite Eight in three consecutive years right before Zach Edey arrived, back in 2020. So they clearly have done this before, and they will look a lot different. I mean, if you just look at them from a wing standpoint, if you want to project out, Miles Colvin and Camden Heidi and Kanan Ketchings, who's coming in, I mean, that's a very different-looking kind of guard wing-oriented offense. And, you know, what does Trey Kaufman Wren look like when you commit him to a little bit more minutes? But obviously, it's just going to look such a 180 from how they've played here in these past few years through Zach Edey.
One last thing. I think you mentioned what stood out to me in the game, and that is, you know, we don't sit here today and Lawyer and Jones missed a bunch of shots. I think this
they didn't get clean looks.
This is the most key thing of the game, and I would love to, you know, I know we had Tom Crean yesterday, but, you know, I'd almost love to pick the brain of a coach, of someone, a basketball Betty, if you will, that knows what is going on there, how next level UConn was, not only in their play, but their dedication to the game plan that, you know, if Lawyer stood out there and was chucking threes and Jones stood out there and they were chucking threes, we could walk in here and today and say they just shot a bad percentage, or we could nitpick on the type of shots, KB, that they made, but they never got the abundance of opportunities. And just think about, you don't have to go back to just the NC State game, but one reason that they have raised their profile this year as a team with the three-point shooting is because of the looks that they get. I mean, Matt Painter, and using the inside game of Zach Edey and the point guard savviness, if you will, of Braden Smith, having a point guard and having a big like Edey, I mean, the thing that you get from that offense and from that improved offense is you get looks. That's the crazy thing. You're right about last night is they didn't get the looks. At times, they didn't have the opportunity to even step to the line and miss that shot. And that's some next-level stuff from UConn, dude.
And it's a total
it really
180
is.
From what NC State did Saturday night. You
totally.
Know, NC State, and they had some success with Edey in turning him over on Saturday night, but, you know, UConn looked at it, and, you know, I kind of had to laugh. This is always how, now, of course, Notre Dame basketball never had a player like Donovan Klingon, but Mike Bray was always a no, threes are worth more than twos. We'll single team the big guy all game long. We'll live with that because you won't be as disciplined to throw it in the post.
Right.
And, you know, there's just a lot of stuff that has to happen for that big, you know, in a way. The big guy at times can be like a running back in the NFL of like, no, I mean, we will live with it. We're not going to let you hit, you know, the 40-yarder.
Yeah, go get 3.5 yards.
And go back to the first half, Andy. Purdue had 2 3-point attempts the entire first half.
And one was at the very end. One was Lawyer's heave at the end,
which,
was it not?
For some reason,
did that count?
I don't think they counted
that.
But the two was the Braden Smith late clock fadeaway in front of the UConn bench, which went in. And the other one was Miles Colvin, a challenge three, somewhat late clock as well. Like, again, I don't feel like this was a guy's afraid of the moment, passing it around the horn, and we're looking for the best shot. It was just an absolute.
It wasn't there.
Yeah, just an absolute, again, suffocation of the three-point line for UConn. Again, Rick Carlisle going to join us here coming up at 8. Certainly a lot of reaction to this. We'll get some audio as well as Zach Edey's career comes to a close. It's crazy to think, you know, at times I thought Edey was just a step or two off, and yet he still has 37.
I know.
I mean, like,
the same thing.
Part of me is like, Kevin, like, don't even say that. But my eyes, I don't think, totally lied. It just seemed like
it wasn't his best game.
Maybe a few rebounds that he usually has. Right. And UConn, 14 offensive rebounds. That is a huge stat as well.
We talked about it. No, the length of the guards and then offensive rebounding. Boy, that was the key last night. We talked about it on Monday. We'll get to some of the sound, but Matt Painter after the game really, really stressed how great, and we've talked about it here, how great that defense was from UConn last night. So 75-60, that's your final in the national championship game. Like KB mentioned, Pacers head coach Rick Carlisle, the NBA was off last night. They're all back at it tonight. Pacers, of course, on the road. I'm trying not to be nervous about this game against Toronto, the stinky Raptors, if you will. So we'll dive into that with Coach Carlisle coming up at 8 o'clock. What did Matt Painter say after last night's championship game? We'll talk about it. Your morning checkdown coming up next. Wake up call, hanging out with you on this Tuesday, 93.5, 107.5 The Fan.
Query and Company.
The best shooter Rick Mount has seen.
down. Omaha! On 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Absolute dominance from the Connecticut Huskies. We will chat, of course, a lot about that today. Pacers actually a double-digit favorite tonight north of the border. Andy Sweeney, though, we certainly have got to lead off a check down the wee hours of the morning out in Phoenix.
Yeah, I thought the game moved along pretty well, though. It wasn't too
bad, KB. One shiny moment at 12:03 a.m.
That's not too bad. Didn't we have the over-under at like 12:20 or something like that?
So, it was a little earlier than I thought.
Yeah. I thought that halftime took forever.
Oh, the halftime's brutal. I think I went and watched an episode of something. I honestly think I did. I was like, I can't do this. Plus, half the guys at the back of the desk, they haven't watched college basketball all year anyway. I've seen more UConn than they have. Anyway, 75-60, that's your final last night. UConn over Purdue in the national title game. UConn's defense, they're rebounding. According to Matt Painter postgame, that was the difference in last night's contest.
In a game like this, we had to be able to rebound defensively better. And then we had to have something balance that out, and that was her threes, and they just stayed home with us. They did a really good job defensively. You know, they get a lot of credit, and Donovan Klingon's a very good defensive player. But we've played against athletes, you know, and played against some really good defensive guys this year and in the tournament, but not the collection of defensive players like UConn has. You know, we'd play against somebody and they'd have a lockdown defender. These guys are bringing lockdown defenders off the bench.
Yeah, and you saw that last night. Again, only 1 of 7 from three-point range were the Boilermakers last night. They shot 73% from the free throw line, but only 15 attempts, 11 of 15. That wasn't enough as well. Now, one thing, KB, you mentioned is, you know, Zach Edey was really good. You could say he was great at times, though. It felt like there were lulls in his game, and he agreed, by the way. Here's Zach Edey postgame.
They did a good job showing, kind of mixing up some defenses, playing some one-on-one. Klingon's a great player, but I just got to play better. This is one of those games where I can't go through stretches where I'm not effective, and I had a few of those stretches today, and that was the game.
You know, whenever Purdue's season was going to end, I just assumed it would be the turnovers. I mean, that was something Matt Painter never hid from. Always pointed out that stat of getting to 14 turnovers as you play with fire like they did Saturday night. Andy, 9 last night, a very acceptable number. That's kind of right at their average. If you'd have told Matt Painter at the start of the night you're going to have 9 turnovers, I think he would have signed up for it.
Well, and Edey was going to have 37 points.
Sure.
If you'd have told him those things, he probably thought he would have won the national title last
night. Yeah, I mean, if you want to boil it down to two things, it's the three-point line and just the shocking lack of attempts and makes and the lack of clean looks. Like, I tweeted out at the end of the game, zero use of the three-point line whatsoever, and someone tweeted back at me, like, I would argue, like, zero, you know, like, availability at the three-point line, and I think that's almost the better way to put it. Like, again, I'm trying to think of clean looks Purdue even had from behind the arc last night. And then the other thing I would point to, non-three-point line division, 14 offensive rebounds. We are just used to Purdue controlling the glass all season long, and UConn, every time it seemed like, oh, wow, Purdue got to stop, boom, they extend a possession there, and they're able to certainly continue to keep Purdue on that defensive end of the floor. So absolutely dominant from UConn. Again, to me, it's the greatest two-year college basketball run I've seen in my lifetime. You look at this tournament run now spanning 12 straight games for them. They just won this tournament by 140 points. That is the differential. That is the best ever in the history of the tournament. And I thought Matt Painter used the right word. It's the collection of guys. It's both ends of the floor. They just seem like they are all singing from the same hymnal. It's you know, for Purdue fans, it wasn't fun to watch. But, boy, offensively, how they cut, how they read each other, beautiful. And then defensively,
just so good, man. They're just so good.
So locked in. Dan Hurley's crazy, but he sure as hell can coach. All right, north of the border tonight, as we mentioned, Pacers and Raptors. No Scotty Barnes. The Raptors also ruled out Emmanuel Quickly. So if you're surprised to see the Pacers favored by 10 on the road, that is why. Again, Indiana could still host a home first-round playoff series, which is kind of crazy, but that's how jumbled things are in the Eastern Conference right now. If you look at the standings, they've got tiebreakers over Milwaukee, over the Knicks, over the Heat, over the Sixers. It's really just the Magic. And that Cavaliers head-to-head, Andy, is still to be determined with those teams matching up on Friday. So first things first, win 2 of 3, You're guaranteed to be a top six seed. Again, it's at Toronto tonight, at Cleveland Friday, home to Atlanta on Sunday. But there is a possibility you could be playing for more than just that six seed here this week.
Yeah, with Carlisle coming up at 8 o'clock, I'll say to you before we have him on, I was going to be a little bit worried about this game, but I don't think I'm allowed to be worried about this game, given everyone that's out. Emmanuel Quickley, you mentioned. Scotty Barnes is out. Grady Dick is a game-time decision. And Jacob Poeltl is also out, who averages 12 points and 9 rebounds a game.
Well, and those three
wow,
really hurt the Pacers last time. You know, the Raptors,
I mean, all of them, yeah,
came into your building and won that game. So that is something, certainly a big reason why the Pacers are favored by 10 tonight.
All right, Major League Baseball scores from last night. Reds winners. Boy, we haven't heard that snarky Reds sounder from Mark Dykton in the
Mark
last couple
Cubs
days.
Mark and sound from last night? Oh, my God.
Jose Quas needs to get DFA'd today.
So the Cubs were up 8-0, right?
Yeah. The game? I went to bed, and I woke up this morning like, what happened? I'm like, oh, for God's
sake.
Can
we go back to the Reds and what Ellie De La Cruz did last night?
Ellie De La Cruz had inside the park home run. He's been good the last two or three games. Maybe
he hit one 450 feet outside the park, and then he also had an inside the park
good
home
enough.
Run.
They all count the same. That's what they say.
Special
Reds,
talent?
Reds, you think so? Maybe not hit him in the – you think he'll be able to move up from the 6 or 7 hole now in the batting order?
Not allowed.
Look now, but here come the Red Legs.
There you go, Kev.
10-8 winners were the Reds last night. We mentioned the Cubbies got up 8-0. They lost 9-8 in San Diego. And the St. Louis Cardinals lost at home yet again, just 5-6 on the season. They lost 5-3. To the Phillies.
The White Sox are terrible this year.
They are god awful.
Unbelievable.
You get the $17 milkshake, though. That thing is really good, I hear.
Well, you're going to need a lot of those to sit there and watch the White Sox. Rick Carlisle joined us. Hey, did you see the Pacers did a little eclipse watch from the airport?
I did.
Before they boarded the plane to Toronto?
How did you enjoy the eclipse? You were being a little bah humbug on the eclipse yesterday.
I left the office about 2:30, and I compared the eclipse to double bubble gum.
It was good for
three minutes,
and
I thought it was really good.
We said about a lot of things.
I thought it was really good. I'm trying to keep it PG. I thought it was really good for about 3 or 4 minutes. You know what I'm talking about, right? The blue and yellow wrapper.
I listen. Of course, I know what you're talking about.
It's like fruit stripe gum.
Yeah, it's like fruit stripe would be even a better example. No, it was.
It was very cool.
It was eerie. It got kind of dark, and then darker, and then darker, and then we were in totality. Yeah.
We did have a neighbor set off a firework, so Max freaked out about that. So luckily, I could kind of shield his eyes for a few minutes there. But I don't think we have any burned retinas, so it was good. I could not believe driving home how many people were just camped out in their yard.
Oh yeah.
Like
everybody.
They had been tailgating all day.
Oh, yeah. A bunch of people.
And IMS, I mean, the crowds. Some of the numbers from IMS, and I did want to make sure that I mentioned this. This is courtesy of Nathan Brown, obviously does a great job covering IndyCar for the Indianapolis Star. Over 50,000 people over at IMS yesterday. All 50 states and 33 countries represented.
Wow.
And 80, this is the biggest number for me, 80% of those 50,000 there for the first time.
Wow.
Good for them.
You know, you think about marketing.
Oh, sure.
You think about trying to, retain an audience.
Yeah.
That's why, the infield looks like the infield does. The EDM concerts on race day and everything. You're trying to get different people to see what is such a unique and unbelievable venue there. So, shout out to Doug Bowles and company. Although, it was not maybe my cup of tea to head out there. Great work by them. In executing that.
Yeah, Jake and Jimmy were glistening out there. Get people to come back for the EDM. If you went there for the eclipse, you got some glow sticks on the way out. Apparently, that's the case. All right, let's take a break. On the other end, we'll keep talking about the game. KB, big picture, what do we think Purdue and Matt Painter can learn from last night? Or is it simply UConn is that good? We'll discuss all of that next. Rick Carlisle at 8 o'clock. It's the wake-up call, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan. Hey, it's Jeremy later on.
Wake Up Call with KB and Andy on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
One of seven from three last night for the Purdue Boilermakers. That's where my eye immediately goes to when I'm looking at this box score. It's just such a shocking number. And again, Andy, I just do not sit here and be like, oh, they passed up a ton of looks and guys were scared and the bright lights of Monday night in the national title just wilted Purdue. I just felt like UConn just so committed to the game plan. Absolute suffocation there on the perimeter. Again, it wasn't the turnover number. That's not what ended Purdue's season. That was probably Matt Painter's biggest worry. It was the three-point line, which was such a weapon for them. I mean, they don't shoot a ton of them, but on average, they're about 8 of 20 from three. And last night, 1 of 7. Dan Hurley is certified crazy. He's Bob Knight in the modern era, and he executed an unbelievable game plan in saying, we will live with Zach Edey pounding it. We will not live with Lawyer, Jones, Smith, Gillis hitting three or four threes and all of a sudden becoming, you know, on the all tournament team or whatever.
Do you like Hurley or not? I can't tell if you like Dan Hurley or not.
I mean, I know every Purdue fan wants to absolutely murder him today.
Well, let's move that aside.
And like everyone wanted him to be thrown out of the game five minutes in, but he is entertaining as hell,
and that's
all I care about.
No, I said, you know, last week I think it was, I was like, you know, if UConn goes on, KB, and they win the national title, you know, we are, you know, Hurley's already been thrown in our face. Dan Hurley's getting ready to really thrown in our face.
I reserve the opinion to change in 6 or 8 months.
The data can change.
But boy, is he just so freaking entertaining.
Well, the difference between him and Matt Painter on their sideline demeanor towards the officials, their own players, the other players. I mean, Hurley got into it with Zach Edey. After one of those timeouts in the first half, they were both jawing at each other, which I love. Listen, I like the antics, but if you're a Purdue fan,
I love the antics.
If you're some of the Big East coaches or teams, you absolutely hate Hurley, and there's nothing you could do about it because he's got the wins. I mean, remember he said when he took that job, something to the effect of, you better get us now.
Right,
this is three years ago. Uh-huh. He said, you better get us now before we start balling out. And then the guy goes out and wins back-to-back national championships.
Well, the thing about Hurley, too, in these comments is, like, he'll answer these questions, and, like, it's a very candid answer, and oftentimes there's a lot of respect for Purdue at various points and complimenting them. But then he'll always throw in, like, the, holy, that was one of the more cockier things that I've ever heard. Like, all of a sudden, post-game last night, he's like, you know, credit to Purdue, you know, clearly the second best team in the nation, but we won by a lot again. I mean, it sounds like just like seventh grade humor from him.
Six games. What did it end up being? 140
plus
points.
Plus 140.
It's an
they
unbelievable
trailed
number.
For 6 minutes in 22 seconds across this 240 minute tournament. I will say this probably quite often on this Tuesday morning. To me, it's more impressive than what Florida did in 06-07, and albeit I was 2 and 3 years old, but I'd argue it's more impressive than UNLV and Duke if you go back to the early 90s. And the reasons. First off, go to the dominance. 12 straight tournament wins, all by at least 13 points. Nobody did that. Hell,
right.
You go even look at the UCLA teams, and it wasn't even that outright dominant from the Wooden era. And then on top of it, they didn't run it back like Florida. Florida brought back, what, the top seven from 06 to 07, something like that?
At least they're starting five they brought back. I'm trying to think who else on the bench. But, yeah, I mean, all the Corey Brewers and the Joakim Noahs and everyone else came back, sure.
And UConn loses not only the top two scorers from last year, but five of their top eight. So it takes a lot for a team to make everyone else in college basketball look like it's JV. But that's kind of what UConn did.
Yeah. Yeah,
I don't say that lightly. Like, I mean, look what Purdue did in the Big Ten, Andy. Look what Purdue did in the non-conference.
They did in the tournament.
I mean, Purdue
they destroyed
beat
multiple teams.
I think coming into the Sweet 16, obviously Purdue was going on their own run, but Purdue had beaten six other Sweet 16 teams, five of them away from home. They had been the first Big Ten team in 50 years to win the Big Ten by multiple games in back-to-back years. I mean, Purdue dominated the non-conference. Dominated the Big Ten again, and then last night, again, I mean, there's just large moments of that game where it looks like varsity and JV, which is just, it, to me, it's just such an unbelievable credit to what Dan Hurley and UConn has built.
Yeah, I want to ask you a question here in a second, but just to add to that, the dominance, and you mentioned the JV nature that other teams felt at times, you know, they were able to make Zach Edey, you know, be a little gassed, and we had not seen that this season. They had made him, you know, while his numbers are really good, they gave, you know, there were stretches where he was not really good, and some of the shots he was making early, instead of being 3-4 feet from the basket, he was 5-7 feet from the basket, and they made, this is the JV nature, that they made the guards, the backcourt that, you know, really had been good for Purdue, they made that extra regular. You know, you look at it, the bench points, and this is, you know, I understand that the bench is not all about getting points, but, you know, last night, the bench for Purdue played 55 minutes, KB. They scored 2 points. Heidi had 2 points. Again, Gillis only took the 2 shots. Gillis, 24 minutes, no points. And then outside of, and this is the stat that is still unbelievable, and it goes to Purdue only scoring 60 points last night, but outside of Braden Smith, his 12 points, and the 37 points from Edey, everybody else on the floor, despite your position, you know, added up to 11 points, and you just can't have that. The question I had that I teased, and this
can
is,
I, can,
yeah, go
can
ahead.
I sneak one
yeah,
more
yeah,
in
go ahead.
On that, on the Edey just not, he just wasn't the same full throttle Edey for 39 minutes, and I feel like I can say that, Andy, because he's proven he can be that. You know, most big guys, it's asinine to ask them to give you that for 40 minutes. But Edey has shown, like, he can do that.
But he's done it, yeah.
Right. And so when he had that, I mean, really Herculean first 10 or 12 minutes, I was, like, audibly laughing at some of the shots he was making because I thought the difficulty was so high. And now looking back on it, I'm thinking, boy, that difficulty was so high, he had to be getting worn down.
Right.
Just having to score over Klingon, through Klingon, all of that. He had that step through with the left hand that got Klingon's first foul. Just an unbelievable move. But I'm thinking, man, that's a hands on the hips, you know, after that play.
Edey was fully in his bag early on.
Right.
Exerting everything that he had.
But it was almost like, boy, that tank is going to empty real quick. And you can point to, I think, several different instances. Again, Rafferty referenced it directly, and then sure enough, Edey travels on the very next possession there, right around like 6 or 7 minutes to go in the first half. And I thought that was when the first big swing happened to UConn. Caleb first comes in the game, boom, Klingon and one, Purdue offensive foul. Edey's got to come back off the bench after 30 seconds. And even just like a 5-point lead at that point felt like things were starting to turn. And then, I mean, remember when Edey airballed the front end of a 1-and-1 after a timeout?
Right.
I mean, what have you? I mean, he is a good, very good free throw shooter.
Yeah.
And like, you never see him do that.
Never see something like that.
The early start to the second half, you know, that's when you're thinking, okay, you're down 6. You know, can all of a sudden you cut it to 3 at the under 16? And now, okay, UConn is back in the huddle. Like, guys, we got some, you know, real game pressure here. I thought he missed a couple shots at the rim. You know, Klingon got a few fouls there right after halftime. And Edey just had a couple looks at the rim that he usually either thunderously finishes or just, you know, certainly makes, and he didn't make those. So, you know, there's part of me that's like, the dude scored 37. Don't, like, nitpick as much as you are. But, again, I'd be remiss. I mean, my eyes were telling me something there. And, yes, the three-point line and the offensive rebounds. If you want to boil it down to two things that, to me, stand above the rest, sure. But I just felt like you didn't get the crazy 40-minute, he's such a rare and unique player, Edey, that we're used to.
Yeah, and no one helped him as well.
This is like fourth on the list, and there's a huge gap
But think
between
about
the others.
It. In hindsight, when he was playing, this is in total hindsight, you know, I'm thinking when Edie's going nuts early on, I'm thinking he's keeping them in the game. Somebody else, eventually that's going to open up what? Other guys are going to step
right.
up.
UConn's going to have to double.
Eventually they're going to, and they did a couple times, and then
but
now like,
with Klingon
and
in
then
it.
They're like, we're not going to do that. You mentioned second half. I want to bring this up. It was a 6-point game because I wrote this down. You get the foul on Klingon. You get the Edie. Now, this is right out of halftime, okay? So you're down six. Things were teetering against you. But, you know, you're Matt Painter. Matt Painter, I thought, had some good out of timeout. You know, he's a very good coach on, you know, they're very good at executing those things. I'm thinking, okay, this first 3-4 minutes, let's see if Purdue can make the punch that is going to show that they're going to be in this game for the duration, and it didn't happen. You get the ball early second half. You get the foul on Klingon. Edie misses a layup. You come down. Newton makes a three. Edie misses a dunk.
That was an offensive rebound three, too.
Edie misses a dunk, and now it's a 9-point game. And now you're a couple minutes into the second half, and you're hoping to get that 6-point game to a 1-point game to a tied game. And now, you know, now let's go play the final 16 minutes. And quite literally, the opposite happened. I wanted to bring up and just ask you, is there the Purdue fan today wakes up and they feel empty and they feel hollow and everything else because they lost last night. And like you mentioned earlier, and even Matt Painter mentioned last night, KB, that they understand that, you know, this team now, you know, these players, some of these players, and of course, Zach Edey, they are going to move on. And so this was, quote unquote, their opportunity, especially with what happened last season. This was their opportunity to win the championship. You know, understandable. You don't know the next time. It could be four decades. You don't know the next time you're going to be back. And the only reason I bring that up is, you know, if you're Purdue, do you look at last night, if you're a fan this morning, do you look at last night as we were the second best team in the country? And if we would not have, you know, been up against this behemoth of UConn that ended up being, you know, a bad fit, a bad matchup, if you will, for us. If it were just about any other team in college basketball this year, we would have won the national title. Or, and I would say on top of it, how does Matt Painter view it? You know, Matt Painter last year understood, hey, we need to be a little bit different. He goes out, he gets Lance Jones in the middle of this season. He brings in more of Cam Heidi. He makes a, you know, a decision. Gillis is going to come off the bench. Is there something else? I mean, is there a player or two in this starting lineup? Obviously not someone like Braden Smith, to where he looks and says, their guards were so good, they dominated our guards. We need to be, and Jones will be gone, obviously. We need to be better at this position or that position, or maybe this guy needs to come off the bench like Gillis did last year. Or is it, it's probably a combination of both. Or is it, we just lost to, unfortunately, if we're a Purdue fan, we lost to this juggernaut that has done something that, quite frankly, we haven't seen in the last 25 years. You understand what I'm trying to get at?
I'd probably say like 80-some percent of it is that last part. Is just, yeah, I mean, you ran into a team that, like you said, has done something, frankly, generational in what UConn has done. But having said that, I think there is a thing where you kind of look in the mirror and say, okay, how can we evolve? How can we really nitpick this operation? Because clearly, you know, like I said to start off the segment, I mean, look at what Purdue has done to the non-conference schedule.
But this is
on an annual basis. Look at what they've done to the Big Ten. I mean, what does it say about the rest of the Big Ten?
This is where I struggle. Their non-conference schedule was so difficult. They could not have challenged
Arizona,
themselves.
Arizona, Alabama, they go to Gonzaga, yeah, Tennessee, Marquette.
They could not have challenged themselves more in the non-con. And the Big Ten, you know, the Big Ten's not as good as it used to be, but you still fly through that league to where you win by multiple games. That's also not normal.
Yeah, and I do think just naturally, Purdue's going, I mean, obviously without Edie, they're going to look different, but they, I mean, just look at Miles Colvin, Camden Heidi, and Kanan Ketchings coming in. I mean, you want to talk about 6'7", 6'8", whatever they are, wings that theoretically all can shoot it, and obviously you saw Heidi's athleticism, which, you know, I think everyone that watches Purdue knows that that's in there, but still, I mean, it's a different looking team than what they have run out there. You know, at some point, do you want whatever Fletcher Lawyer and more of a fourth or fifth option role? Yeah, I think that would be kind of an ideal nature to it. I thought Braden Smith was fine last night. I feel like at times Braden Smith like got grouped into Fletcher Lawyer, and I don't know, maybe this is more the national talk.
Braden's being hawked up and down that floor
from
last
night. Yeah, I thought he quarterbacked it pretty darn well. To me, you just couldn't have the no-shows from Lawyer and Lance. I mean, Lance had that one and one take early, and that was it.
And that's it.
And, you know, he's your guy that has a little crazy to him and has that jolt. And when you get into these lulls and you get into, you know, suffocating defense. He's the one that's supposed to be able to kind of, hey, he'll do something crazy, and sometimes you need that to get out of it. So I just think naturally with how Purdue is going to have to react to post ED, and then how they've recruited, I think they will look differently. And then, of course, I mean, does Will Berg turn into something? Is Trey Kaufman Wren now a 13-8 guy?
Yeah, what's he now?
Moving forward, but I think there might be a tweak or two. But at the same time, I mean, they've been undefeated in a loaded non-conference schedule each of the last 3 years. I mean, it's insane. And then again, they've done something that no Big Ten team has done in 50 years. So a tweak, sure. But all of a sudden, crumbling up and throwing it in the trash?
Yeah.
That'd be probably insane to do.
Yeah, I'm interested whenever Matt Painter does, you know, gets to kind of look at, maybe he'll go with JMV or us or somebody else and kind of, or do a press conference now as the season's over with the local media gas bags and kind of exhale and say, here's what I think moving forward. As for Braden Smith, last thing on him, he was very much like an NFL quarterback who just had pressure in his face all the time. I mean, that's how what he had to deal with last night with those UConn guards. All right, coming up on the other end, Pacers head coach Rick Carlisle. What is he like about where his team's at? Plus, he'll give us a preview of the game tonight in Toronto. Hanging out with you until 10 o'clock on this Monday. It's the Wake Up Call, 93.5, 107.5 The Fan.
Juicy Juice is 100% juice.
It's the Wake Up Call with KB and Andy on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
All right, it's Tuesday. It's 8 o'clock. You know what that means. Head coach of the Indiana Pacers coming off a big, big-time win. You talk about franchise regular season wins. They don't get much bigger than what the Pacers did on Sunday, and it's been a busy kind of 48 hours since then, even off the floor for the Pacers. We'll get to that with Rick Carlisle here. Right now, as it's Pacers and Raptors tonight north of the border. Coach, good morning. Were you able to dial up? Was it maybe TSN to watch the national title game last night in your hotel room?
Yeah, the game was on. It was interesting. I'm not sure exactly what it was, but there was it sounded like a radio broadcast that was kind of done like simulcast. Jay Billis was the analyst, and there was another gentleman doing the play-by-play, and then they would go to Tracy Wolfson, and it seemed like there was a double broadcast going on or something, but it was good. And the game obviously was was a tough game for Purdue. My take, if you're gonna ask, which I assume you might at some point, but I thought Matt Painter just did a phenomenal, amazing job this year, and they're just unlucky. I mean, they just ran into the wrong team at the wrong time in history. I mean, Connecticut was just so highly manned at every position, so deep, so skilled, so tough, and so tied together that it was it turned out to be just an impossible task. But Purdue just they were spectacular this year, and just a disappointing end. But even though the game was tough, I mean they competed hard, and it was just a tough night.
When you watch a game like that, are you watching that game, and whether it be Zach Edey or, of course, Klingon or the UConn guards, are you watching that game and kind of in your mind projecting, as a guy who runs an organization, and coaches in the NBA, are you projecting, hey, here's how I think this guy or that guy can fit at the next level?
Well, I suppose you can't help but do that a little bit, but very interestingly, you know, Zach Edey last year, if he had come out last year, he may have been a first round pick, but you know, he may also have been somewhere in the second round. And this year coming up, I mean, he is up there in the first round somewhere. I don't know. I haven't looked at the draft boards or anything like that, but you know, the guy could have had 40 points last night. And you know, it's pretty clear what Connecticut was doing. I mean, they played most of the game straight up on him with Klingon, and they were, you know, trying to take away threes. I don't know if, you know, I know Purdue had one three at one point in the game. I don't know if they ever even got a second three, but you know, you take all those threes out of the game, and you know, just make them grind for twos, and then at the other end you're getting twos and threes. I mean, it's tough sledding.
One of seven from three. Three makes, eight attempts. That was the previous season low. So season lows in both of those for Purdue last night. Rick Carlisle with the Sear Payless Liquors Hotline. Again, Pacers and Raptors tonight north of the border. We definitely want to get to your basketball team here in just a second, but I'd remiss. Looked like before you guys boarded the plane, you had a little viewing experience for the eclipse yesterday. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, phenomenal. I mean, you hear all the stuff about all the people traveling to Indiana, and you know, yeah, we had all these warnings. You know, traffic is going to be crazy, and there might be, you know, some bad activity with, you know, this. I mean, the roads were empty, and we got there, and it was really a perfect day, and you know, everybody's got the glasses, and I mean, the whole thing was. A lot of people downplayed it and you know, said, you know, this is kind of a kooky thing, and why would you travel from all across the country? And I mean, this thing was unbelievable. It was just unbelievable. And so the amazing part to me was you know, not only did it become dark, but the temperature went down. I don't know how many degrees.
Yeah.
It went down at least 10 or 12 degrees. And, you know, we had our entire travel party, you know, out on the tarmac, and they had folded chairs set up, and it was a beautiful day. It felt like San Diego, you know, in Indianapolis, and it completely memorable. So, you know, just fantastic.
Rick Carlisle with us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. See, Coach, you can like it. KB wasn't too hot on the eclipse, and I told him, hey, this is the
I was nervous about the traffic.
This is a once-in-a-lifetime
thing. I fell for the traffic rabbit hole. It was a breeze. Driving home, there was nobody on the road.
He got scared off by the media, Coach. That must have been what it was. Rick Carlisle with us, Pacers head coach. Of course, they get ready for Toronto tonight. That tip-off at 7 o'clock. Our coverage here on the Fan beginning at 6:30. Boy, I tell you, the OKC win, Coach, and then you come back, and we talked so much on that game on Sunday, how much that was going to mean, not only for playoffs, but for seeding, and you guys win 117-115 over Miami. And since the All-Star break, you guys have been 2-7 in those clutch game situations. What was different on Sunday, and overall, this weekend, you guys took care of business. What did you like? What did you like from your team and how they played?
Well, we played 48 minutes. You know, really, we played very, very well from beginning to end. And, you know, this sounds a little trite, a little basketball speakish, but, you know, our Pacers basketball is 48 minutes. And we saw a really good example last week in Brooklyn where, you know, the first 4 minutes of the game, we get down 11-4. And then, yeah, we have to call timeout. We come over and we talk about it, and we get the wheels back on the wagon, and then we go on a pretty good run and get a double-figure lead in the first half, and then we come out in the second half, and we're down 9-1 to start the second half. And the only point we scored was, I think, because Schroeder got a technical foul. And so, you know, you go down, you know, 20-5 in that 7 minute span. I mean, those 7 minutes, you cannot get back, and regardless of what else happens throughout the game. And so, you know, Sunday, you know, we played really well in the first half. We played really well in the third quarter. We didn't really have any of those kinds of lags at all. And you're never going to play a perfect game, but the way we competed, you know, in that first 36 minutes, set us up for the fourth quarter, and you knew this was going to be tough. You knew this was not going to be just an easy game, and they made a run, and some crazy things happened, and they threw in some ridiculous shots, and then we fouled a couple times on three-point shots, and before you know it, it's a one-possession game. But at that point, we had done enough to absorb that kind of run, you know, in the scope of the entire 48 minutes, and we showed great poise. You know, we executed an intentional foul on a three-point shot up three, and were able to survive it. And so, you know, it was a great win, and it's a kind of experience that our team needs right now. But the lesson for us, you know, as we head into tonight in Toronto with a team that, you know, seemingly doesn't have much to play for on the one hand. On the other hand, I mean, they have been killing it the last two games. They won in Milwaukee, and then they kicked Washington's butt 2 nights ago, and 42 points in the first quarter. So, you know, we're running into a Brooklyn type scenario here on the road, and we're going to have to be ready, and we're going to have to do a better job.
Pacers Raptors tonight. It'll be in Cleveland Friday. Close out the regular season against Atlanta Sunday, and already at 45 wins, 25, 35, 45. That's been the progression here over the last three seasons. Obviously, Rick Carlisle, a massive part of that. He's with us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Coach, last week I asked you about T.J. McConnell and his just endless contributions off the bench, and I'd be remiss if I didn't ask about Obi Toppin. Continue to be thoroughly impressed by what he's given you. And, you know, in a year where you've, you know, put him in different roles, and obviously the bench has not been some, you know, steady personnel operation. You've had to try, and injuries have forced you into a lot of different combos there. What have you seen from Obi in your first year with him?
Well, really love him. I mean, beautiful person, highly skilled. I mean, how often are you going to find a 6'10 guy that can, who could probably, you know, he's probably an Olympic caliber, you know, athlete as far as, you know, if you put him in the, you know, in the Olympic trials for the 220 or the 440, the way he runs, I mean, he'd be competitive. You know, I don't know where he would be in the whole thing, but he's that kind of athlete, skill wise. I mean, he handles it, he passes it, he has feel. We've asked him this year to concentrate on his defense and rebounding. He's gotten better in both areas, and he's just been the ultimate, you know, team guy. And so, you know, with him and Pascal Siakam, you know, we've got a really good 1-2 punch at the four position. And then, as you've seen at times, you know, when they go with Kevin Love out there at five, or, you know, tonight there's going to be situations where they go small. You know, we have Obi at five as more than a viable option. It's now a lineup that's just simply a go-to lineup, and we can switch and we can do other things. We could still have the ability to defend. So he's been terrific. And, you know, I really believe that Indiana's been a great situation for him coming off of his Knicks experience. He did a great job with the Knicks over 2 or 3 years, whatever it was, and developed each year. But he's taken an additional step this year, and certainly has been an enormous part of any success we've had.
Coach, I feel like we see it a little bit more in the college game, but in the last couple of weeks, twice you've been in a situation where do you foul up three? We saw it, of course, with that Chicago game a couple weeks ago, and then again on Sunday with Miami. How much is that like a debate with your staff, or has that kind of always been your locked-in principle of we will foul up three, whatever, given X amount of time left on the clock?
Well, there are always a certain set of factors that you have to consider. One thing is, you know, do you have the ability to make the judgment call on screening, or excuse me, a fouling on the catch, you know, facing away from the basket, not in the shooting motion? I mean, we've seen over the years, I mean, it's always a nightmare, you know, with guys like Kobe Bryant. You know, they were so clever, so crafty, that he would just angle his body, and on the catch he would be turning and shooting, and he had to be very, very aware. Otherwise, you'd foul him in the act of shooting, and then the guy might make a shot, and you'd give up 4 points, you know, or something like that. So that's one thing. The other thing is, do you have a good enough rebounding team? So, you know, the other night, in the Chicago game, we put five big guys out there. We had a ball that caromed off there, and Obi couldn't get his hands on it, knocked it out of bounds, and they got it back and scored. And so now we end up in overtime. The other night, you know, they had a violation, and so it was our ball, but we did a pretty good job of blocking out, et cetera. So, you know, it's not as simple as just, hey, you foul up three, you're good, you're automatically good. You know, it just doesn't always go that way. There's a certain time threshold. If there's too much time on the clock, it's something that's not in the cards for us. So, you know, you got to be somewhere under 10 seconds. I don't want to get into the whole thing, but anyway, it worked out the other night. It's special teams in basketball is exactly what it is. And, you've got to spend time on it, and, you know, you've got to know all the risk factors as well, but it worked out in the Miami game, and all was good.
Pacers and Raptors tonight, our coverage here on The Fan beginning at 6:30. Rick Carlisle joining us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. A couple weeks ago, Coach, I asked you this, and you were very honest. You were like, we're watching where what the standings look like. You wake up this morning, currently the sixth seed, now just a game behind Cleveland. You guys actually have about a 48% chance, Coach, to get up there to the fifth seed, but we know Miami and Philly are right behind you, just three games left for you guys. So how much are you watching the standings? And I know you're not going to tell us the matchup, but internally looking forward, are you kind of hoping maybe that there's a matchup that you could get in the first round over another, perhaps?
I'm not watching it at all right now. You know, it's we gotta focus on what's in front of us. And with three games left, I mean, you can get into a lot of those detailed speculatory conversations. It would be unhealthy for us to do that. What I do know is that, you know, we have another Brooklyn type scenario tonight. We're going to have to do a much better job with it. We're going to have to be much stronger throughout the game, as I mentioned. And, you know, we got to work to continue building habits over these three games. And whatever happens at the end, happens at the end. I mean, there's a possibility of some significant movement, you know, over the last three games. I think I may have told you guys this, you know, my first year in Dallas, we were fighting all year just to get into the playoffs. We had a good team. And then on the last night of the season, you know, we beat Houston at home, which ensured we were going to be at least in the eighth spot. And then a couple of different wacky things happened. Michael Finley, who was playing with the Spurs at the time, hit a game-winning shot. And all of a sudden, San Antonio beat, I think it might have been New Orleans or something like that. And all of a sudden, we end up in the sixth position. And this is long before the play-in or any of that kind of stuff. And it got us into a favorable matchup at 6-3, ironically against San Antonio, who wasn't completely healthy, and we beat them 4-1. So, you know, I don't know what's going to happen. I just do know that, you know, it's bad for karma.
Sure.
to start looking ahead. It's, you know, it's just, you know, it's like anything else. You start speculating things that you don't have control over. And if this team loses to that team and this, that, and the other, and that's why I don't look at scores or, you know, it's not very frequently that I watch games at night because unless it's an opponent that we have the following night or something like that, because, you know, you get so worked up about things you have zero control over. So what we do have control over is, you know, our meeting this morning, our shoot around walkthrough this morning over at the arena. And then, you know, how we walk out there tonight at 7, and we'll be concentrating on those things.
Pacers head coach Rick Carlisle here with us on the wake-up call on the Payless Liquors hotline. I figured I'd give you a forum here. We haven't had a conversation with you since the owner there, Herb Simon, officially elected into the Hall of Fame. Such a cool honor. 89 years old, longest tenured owner in NBA history. I figured I'd give you a few minutes to celebrate that great honor that was announced last week.
Yeah, just so well deserved. And you know, Herb is a very unique owner. You know, there's a new age of owners that have come in over the last several years. I say several years. You know, Mark Cuban bought the Mavericks, I think, back in January of 2000. And you know, Mark made a name for himself by completely rebranding the Dallas Mavericks and doing things in an overt way. He was very much out in front. He was all over the media, and he changed NBA basketball for the better in so many ways. But he did it in a way that was very much his personality, and that was by, you know, being out there. You know, Herb Simon is a guy that, you know, this is the third time I've been with the Pacers. I was with the Pacers as an assistant coach from 97 to 2000 with Larry Bird as the head coach. Came back in 03, you know, for a four-year run. And then, you know, after 13 years in Dallas, I end up back here again. And a big part of it was, you know, the relationship that I had with Herb and the Simon family. And there was a familiarity there. And so, you know, what I'm getting at here is, you know, Herb is a guy that I have never seen in the locker room. You know, if the night of a game, after a game, I mean, if he comes to the facility, you know, he'll stay upstairs at the there's like a catwalk up above and look down, but he just never comes down. and directly engages, you know, with the players very often. I mean, and so he's a very much private, behind the scenes person that has moved mountains over 40 years. I mean, took over a franchise that was failing back in 83. There were like eight to 10 million in debt or something like that. You know, they purchased it for $5 or $6 million and then completely reinvented the Indiana Pacers franchise. And over the years, you know, 8 trips to the conference finals, 1 trip to the NBA finals. The guy's been a massive force behind the scenes on all kinds of committees in support of the game. And so, you know, this is a nod to a man that has just quietly gone about his business. I don't even know how he was nominated. The nomination process is something that has to happen for someone to be considered. But he was so well deserved. And Herb is a guy that would have been, just knowing him, would have been completely embarrassed to even be nominated. You know, why you put my name out there like that? You know,
he's not that kind of guy,
but
yeah,
you know, as we saw the other night, I mean, they had a thing during the Miami game where they announced it officially and they had a camera on him and he stood up and acknowledged everyone. And I just look at him in that moment, and he's got his son Sean, who's at University of Southern California, who's a great kid and so proud of his dad. And it must have been a very, very fulfilling moment for him. Very unexpected, you know. He would tell you that. I mean, that's just the kind of man that he is. But he is a giant of a man, and he and his brother Melvin, who is another man's man, that was, you know, who just moved heaven on earth in Indianapolis and made Indiana, the city of Indianapolis, the Pacers organization, the Pacers franchise on the floor better, you know. And Herb has done it over 40 years. He is the longest tenured owner in NBA history. And just think about that. And so very, very, very well deserved for a man who is so very, very humble.
Really well said, because certainly some people in positions of that authority, they choose to live in a different spotlight than Herb Simon. So appreciate those words there, Coach. Good luck tonight. Congrats on everything so far. I know there's more still to be accomplished, but to get to that 45-win mark and be on the track to get into one of those 7-game opening round series, it's a big step for the franchise. So congrats on that direction, and hopefully you guys finish off this regular season well this week. Thanks, Coach.
All right. Thanks, guys. Take care.
Rick Carlisle, north of the border tonight. Again, 10-point favorite. Big number, no Scotty Barnes. Emmanuel Quickley, who went off against the Pacers a couple weeks ago, is out. Some other guys questionable. So an opportunity to send a team heading to Cancun to Cancun. Granted, as Rick Carlisle said, they have won 2 in a row. Now, granted, no Giannis in that Bucks game. And again, Quickley is a big, big loss for them right now. So take care of business. And you still got an opportunity to climb even higher in the standings.
Yeah, that spread's actually up to, I'm seeing in a few places, 11.5 now.
That might be the biggest,
a lot of points.
That might be the biggest road favorite they've been all year.
Since it opened, it's up 5 points. So
really?
You wonder, you know, when the Barnes news, especially the Emmanuel Quickley news, came out yesterday, what that would look like on the betting line. It's worth 5 points, which is massive.
Leading off a morning checkdown, got to go back to last night, and certainly a dud of a finish to what was a hell of a season for the Boilers.
The morning checkdown.
Omaha! 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 Omaha!
On 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Yeah, let's jump into it. That's what we've been talking about all morning, the national championship game there in Phoenix. 75-60, that's your final. UConn over Purdue. Post-game, let's hear from Matt Painter praising that great UConn defense.
They're a great defensive team.
And so they just made a decision, like, we can defend the perimeter, and we can take this away from you, and then you're just going to get the ball to your best player, and then he's just going to be one-on-one, and then that's that. And they were going to live with that. So if we could have rebounded the basketball better, we could have got them to change and do that. But we weren't able to do that, and then they stayed in control of the game. So not everybody can do what they just did. You know, you have to give credit to their defense and their coach and how they're wired.
Yeah, their defense, great, especially the guards. And you look at it, KB mentioned the rebounding. Goodness, when's the last time you saw Purdue get whooped on the boards? It happened last night, 35-28 was your final there on the rebounding edge. Let me give you one more piece of sound. Zach Edey after the game, you can hear here at the end, getting a little emotional as he talked about his college experience there with Purdue and the Boilers.
It's tough to think about that right now. I've always said, paying someone who kind of just gave me a chance. I've been trying for 4 years to pay him back for that. But he just came in. Like, he believed in me when not a lot of people believed in me. And he gave me the ball. Not a lot of coaches did that. Not a lot of coaches trusted me in that role. Yeah, sorry. It's tough for me to think of stuff like that right now.
I mentioned this before about Zach Edey. You know, I think at times we act like this dude was playing for some 1A school in the middle of nowhere of Canada. Like, he went to IMG Academy.
Right.
Mark Williams was the guy ahead of him on that IMG team who ended up being a lottery pick. A lot of coaches go through IMG Academy. There had to be a belief from the Purdue staff that obviously they could get more out of him. They could develop all of those things. It was certainly a credit there to one of the best players our state, the conference, certainly college basketball has ever seen. But going back to last night, again, I just can't get away from the 1 of 7 from three. And a massive credit to Dan Hurley. I mean, he said it to Tracy Wolfson early on when Edey had really established himself. Klingon gets that early foul. You know, Hurley saying to, okay, do we need to do something differently with Edey? Do we need a double? And he stood by it, thought that they could kind of weather that storm, and he was exactly right. The 1 3-point make, obviously a season low. The 7 attempts for Purdue.
Stunning.
Also a season low.
Stunning.
Fewest for the program in 10 years, fewest in a national title game since 1995. Again, it wasn't the turnover number. You kept the turnover number at a reasonable number. That was 9. It was the inability to use that 3-point line. And as we've talked about all morning long, Andy, I don't view this as Fletcher Lawyer, Lance Jones, Braden Smith, Mason Gillis scared of the moment or passing up good looks or hesitant to embrace that limelight. I credit UConn for just absolutely suffocating Purdue on the perimeter and nothing clean whatsoever. I mean, go back and watch the 7 attempts for Purdue. Almost all of them are challenged.
Or deep.
Or both.
And or deep. Yeah.
I mean, like,
I know.
Almost all of them were. So, unbelievable by Purdue. They couldn't offset it with the foul line, as Matt Painter mentioned, the rebounding issue as well. But when you only attempt 7 threes, and you only get to the foul line 15 times, which is well below Purdue's average, you're going to have your lowest output of the year, and that's what Purdue did scoring-wise.
All of that stuff is interconnected. I mean, so many times, even NC State early on, how many times do they get an offensive rebound, and now Jones or Lawyer is open after it's a scramble mode, you get an offensive rebound, they're having to set their defense.
That's how they hit the early threes on Saturday night.
It's how they did it Saturday night. I'm sure somewhere they have the analytics of when we do get an offensive rebound, how many times then we're fouled in that scramble. You know, Edey gets the offensive rebound. He's going to go back up. Boom, there's a foul. That's just something that did not happen. UConn's just impressive. Defensively rebounding, they were great.
The only thing I care about Major League Baseball-wise yesterday, Ellie De La Cruz hit a home run 450 feet, and he also hit a line drive to center field that turned into a home run. You think he's a special talent?
Well, I mean, I think he's
inside the Parker and a 450-footer.
Who's saying he's not a special talent? Everyone knows he's a special talent.
Mark, good win for the Cubs.
You know, it doesn't matter if it's 162 where it falls on the calendar. That was a bad loss, and it's kind of
nothing.
Concerned.
The Cubs were leading probably when you went to bed.
Oh yeah,
I went to bed and they were up 8-1 or something like that. It's one of those things where like the Cubs' starting pitching has been very good, their offense has been very good, but their bullpen is not very good, and it's cost them a couple times where they put up big numbers and then all of a sudden that game gets very, very close, and unfortunately they imploded and cost them a win.
Not going to act like it's on the same level, but I hope Matt Painter didn't check his Cubs score You know,
he might have been a little distracted.
You think he was worried? You think he got did off he get the podium?
Eight,
the
halftime was so long. Did he get the 8-0 update and then come back in after the end of the game and see 9-8?
I swear, I went and I watched an entire episode of The Office. I think during the halftime. You guys,
I almost went to live from the Masters and watched that during halftime.
Oh, is God. That? Oh my God, is that what
was
you did?
What was on at that point? Just like darkness and wind blowing.
Well, no, they have all the pre-recorded stuff from the practice rounds.
That's not live from the Masters, then. That's pre-recorded from the Masters.
No, no, no. You do it live from 7 to 9, re-air from 9 to 11. It's a beautiful television program.
I'm sure
I encourage everyone to watch it.
Watch the azaleas slightly bloom half an inch.
An eclipse at Augusta? That had to be pretty cool.
Did you see the Masters glasses they gave out with those?
I did see those.
Did you want to get a pair of those?
I was a little jealous of them. I'm not going to lie.
Marty Smith did. He put the glasses that Augusta was giving out for the eclipse. And you know, if someone needs, you know, in a pinch, a couple $100s, you can put those suckers right on the internet.
They should sell those in the merchandise shop for about
$150. For $150, and somebody's going to buy them. Quickly, the Cardinals, everyone can be happy. The St. Louis Cardinals lost to the Phillies last night 5-3.
Again, Patriots tonight, that's 7 o'clock, right?
I think 7 o'clock.
7:30 Friday, 1 o'clock Sunday. So a variety of tip times here as the Pacers close out their regular season. Again, still very much, as Andy pointed out to Rick Carlisle, still very much up in the air on what seeds they can get. They could be as high as hosting a first-round playoff series. So a lot to play for this week as they are a big favorite tonight north of the border.
Yeah, I have a question. Coming up on the other end, I have a question as it pertains to Zach Edey. We know he's great. After the game, I thought Painter and Braden Smith talked about kind of the burden he had to carry and maybe some of the negative things people had said about his game. So a question on Edey. We'll keep the Purdue conversation going. We got you to 10 o'clock on this Tuesday. Wake up call 93.5-107.5 The Fan.
I'm John Morgan of Morgan & Morgan.
Wake-Up Call with KB and Andy on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Can I tell you guys the happiest moment of last night's game for me?
Probably one of the live reads that Ian Eagle did on the Masters this weekend. Let me guess.
Boy, you know me well. We've only been doing this for about 8 months.
Yeah, well, you have a tell. You always talk about golf and the Masters, so it's not very difficult.
And now I'm even happier because Cluster Truck Pimento Cheese Sandwiches available all week long. Shout out to Evan. Just brought some in studio. Cannot wait to consume that.
They look amazing.
That'll be my first pimento cheese I've ever tried.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Oh, outstanding,
you've
Mark.
You've had pimento cheese, though,
no,
right?
No, I don't think I have.
You've never had pimento cheese.
I'm breaking the seal here.
Oh, my God.
Gosh, here, Mark. Let me hand you this. gift card to Cluster Truck. We're giving away all week long on the pop quiz, so we'll do that coming up here. In a bit, the fan is the promo code as well. So $25 or more, you get the fan promo code. You get 25% off, $25 or more in order via Cluster Truck. So a must as we get ready to get into Masters Week. Will Haskett Thursday, Mark?
Yes.
Is that correct?
Thursday, locked in for Thursday. And then sounds like we'll have him on Monday as well, still narrowing down times, but we'll get your golf fix for you, Kev.
So Jim Nance not doing the double dip, right? Ian Eagle, obviously.
He did great.
To be honest, yeah. I'd rather have Ian Eagle than Jim Nance on the final four call. I know that might be like blasphemy to say as a sports media person, but I think Ian Eagle's great.
Jim Nance, I mean, did Ian Eagle give us tie out last night to anybody, or he didn't do that? I mean, that's why we love Jim Nance. By the way, how is it, Mark?
Outstanding.
I think Tristan Newton's really heartbroken he didn't get a tie for most outstanding player.
I think he probably was. Look how happy Mark Dighton is having that pimento cheese sandwich from
Buster
Truck.
That's biscuits and gravy and pimento cheese sandwich.
I know what to expect. That's outstanding.
From Mark Dighton.
It really is.
On this Tuesday morning. Anything we've missed, Andy, from last night? I thought Braden Smith bounced back nicely. I thought he quarterbacked it pretty well. I know it wasn't, you know, a first-team All-American or maybe even a first-team All-Big Ten type of night. And when you watch how Fletcher Lawyer and Lance Jones were so non-existent, maybe that sets the bar pretty low. But I did think Braden Smith, did a nice job there, especially in that first half when, again, the perimeter game was virtually non-existent of getting to the lane, making some plays happen for Purdue, even if you might look at the stat sheet and then not just come off crystal clear to you. I did think that hat tip to Braden Smith for bouncing back from such an ugly Saturday night.
We said this like an hour ago. Braden Smith was the quarterback who threw for 300 yards, and maybe he had an interception or two or a strip fumble, but he had the defense in his face all night. I mean, I know Lawyer obviously had the off night and that he didn't get clean looks, and we know with Jones as well, but Braden Smith is the one that had to deal with the ball hawking, if you will, of this UConn team. So I'm with you. I thought Braden Smith was fine. If you go through the different reasons why Purdue lost last night, I'm not putting it on Braden Smith.
Right, exactly.
Edie, mm-hmm. Edie had some stretches that he even admitted postgame that he wasn't great. I'm sure when Braden Smith goes back and watches some film, he's going to look at it and say, there are a couple things here that I missed that I didn't do well. You know, he had a couple – I thought it was surprising. There's probably three or four times that he had that elbow mid-range jumper.
Right.
And even Raf talked about it during the broadcast. He's like, I can't believe he's missing these. These are shots that are pretty automatic for Braden Smith. So if I had to nitpick, he knocks down a couple of those. I don't know, you know, early on, first half, early second half, how that would change a game. We'll never know, but that would be nitpicking. I did want to bring up one Edie thing. Let's play this, Mark. It's about 35 seconds, so it's a little long, but Matt Painter, after the game, was just asked about Edie, and he said so much of the greatness of Zach Edie and how he'll go down as one of the greatest of all times. He also made an interesting parallel, an example. I wanted to have you hear this. I wanted to react to the villain nature, if you will, of Zach Edie.
I always call it cartoon bad guy. You know, you ever watch the cartoons and there's the bad guy that gets all the hate and everybody's coming at him. You know, like the best player in college basketball, the best player in your conference becomes cartoon bad guy. And so, like, that's just, you know, it's the way it is. But it's also a backhanded compliment. There's millions of basketball players out there that would love to carry that burden. Not everybody can do it. Very few get that. And, you know, he's done it, and he shows up. Like, I'd always say, like, when is he just going to have a bad game? Like, when is he just not going to show up? He always showed up. He always competed. He always played through physicality. He, you know, he's a very unselfish player. And I think that's the piece of it.
It's really well said by Matt Painter. I think naturally we hate tall people in basketball. We just do. We're just jealous of them. We always sit here and say, well, if I were that tall, I'd be doing that. Why did I go on the 10-minute Zach Edey tall rant a few weeks ago? I thought it was the stupidest thing I had heard.
And then we did the next day after you didn't want to talk about it.
I know. Yeah. Then I had to go back and reiterate my stance. I also think the easy way out for Zach Edey last year would have been to go pro. You know, coming back, he brings a risk of injury, which for a guy that's 7'4", 300 pounds, you would think that might be a little bit higher than others. It's not like he went back and it was like, oh, yeah, if you just go back, man, you'll be good. You're going to climb 20 spots in the draft. That was no guarantee in coming back to Purdue. And outside of getting to a Final Four, this season would have been viewed largely as a disappointment unless you got there.
Sure. I mean, there's no doubt about it. No doubt.
And so for him to go back for legacy reasons, I don't think you see a lot of 20-whatever-year-olds doing that in today's college sports climate. And sure, NIL helped him in, you know, the compensation of, okay, what am I going to make as a second rounder? But I just have so much credit and respect for Zach Edey and, you know, how he goes about his business, the development of him, and certainly his decision to come back. And he will certainly go down in Purdue lore as one of the greatest players, bar none, in that program's history, and really one of the greatest players we've seen in the state and in college basketball.
I loved, there was a bunch of, I don't know the answer to this, Zach Edey, Klingon, there's a few. I wonder how many players in last night's game made more money than Brock Purdy made last year for the San Francisco 49ers. Base salary. I wonder how many NIL salaries were above Brock Purdy's base salary. I'll say this, you know, Brayden Smith, even after the game, to back up what Matt Painter said, Brayden Smith, even after the game, was, you know, talking about the, you know, well, you know, he catches a lot of bleep to Zach Edey. I'm going to agree and disagree with something you said. You said tall people in basketball we look at like this. I would even say it's this. I would say it's the tall person that has the game like Zach Edey. Because if you're 7 foot, I mean, Kevin Durant's a 7 footer or Wemby is a 7 footer, but they're perimeter players. They're jump shooters. We love that. We just don't love anymore the way that Zach Edey plays. But I'm more interested in, Purdue has mentioned this, Matt Painter and the players have mentioned this a lot this season, on Zach Edey being kind of this, I think cartoon villain is a great way to say it, that Painter said it. And I wonder for him, Edey, once he gets to the next level, he won't obviously, you know, they'll be big players. They won't be 7-5. They won't be the big maple like he is. But I do wonder how we'll think about him, how that will change. Does that make sense? He's not going to be a focal point. I'm interested how his game, the really, really good parts of his game, KB, how they mesh in the NBA game. And I guess for me, I understand some of the stuff that other fan bases, whether it be IU or Big Ten fan bases, what they say about Zach Edey. But I don't know. I guess I never viewed him. At times, it's plotting. At times, it can be a dry offense. But you understand why Matt Painter throws the ball or threw the ball in the last couple years into Edey. I guess I just never saw him in that villain role or this role that we're tired of watching him play. Does that make sense? I know some people have kind of viewed him through that prism. I've never viewed Edey through that prism.
No, I mean, frankly, I think it's pretty impressive to watch the development and to watch the growth. And I get it. Maybe if you just kind of fly in randomly and watch Purdue, you don't maybe care for it or want to care for it, which is fine. I get it. You know, a little bit more perimeter oriented is maybe a little bit more of an entertaining cup of tea. Boy, are IU fans just – is it Dance on Graves Day?
No, yeah, 1,000%. I had a buddy send me literally 30 seconds ago from Chronic Hoosier, now available in April Traditions, Purdue choking in the tournament since 1969.
Is that a strain, Chronic Hoosiers?
Oh, goodness.
I just got a text here from, I assume, an IU fan. I'd rather have 20 more years of Mike Woodson than to see Purdue win.
Oh, I mean, they could make that happen.
Did I do that?
I was about to say, settle down. That could happen.
When Buckner's in a position of major authority, you just snap your fingers and...
People live longer these days.
Hell yeah.
Modern science, Kevin Bowen. Modern science.
That can happen. I do want to make sure... We'll sneak in a little IMS eclipse numbers. I do want to make sure we get to that. But again, getting back to Purdue, just so much of it from last night boils down to three-point line, offensive rebounding. Having said that, I'm fascinated to see how Purdue looks moving forward. Because, again, it could be a big-time shift. I don't know. Maybe Will Berg is hiding in the weeds, and all of a sudden he's ready to emerge. But Purdue's going to look a little bit more normal, for lack of a better term, in just how they line up
right
from a height standpoint. But at the same time, you could argue that their guard and wing skill moving forward is going to be a little bit more dynamic than they've had. And, not to act like Carson Edwards is on this basketball team, but, they made an Elite Eight just a handful of years ago with, Matt Harms and Grady Eifert as their big guys, if you want to, label them as that. So I'm very curious to see how Matt Painter evolves here, obviously, post one of the greatest players that program's ever seen.
Coming up on the other side, which high major college basketball coach was walking his dog in a stroller? We'll tell you who on the other end. It's the Wake Up Call, hanging out on this Tuesday until 10 o'clock on The Fan.
Progressive presents Renters MVP's Most Valuable.
the Wake Up Call with KB and Andy on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Joke today that UConn had an eclipse around the three-point line last night for Purdue. Boy, those crowd shots at IMS yesterday, some big, I mean, those were carb day, maybe carb day on steroids a little bit. Numbers, 50,000 plus. This is courtesy of Nathan Brown from the Indy Star on the numbers over at IMS yesterday. 50 states and 33 countries represented, Andy. And I would say the number that stands out to me the most, 80% of that crowd first-timers. I mean, you want to talk about, like, marketing dreams.
I'm
That's
stunned.
Exactly what you want.
Yeah.
The unique visitors. IMS, shout-out to Doug Bowles and company over there for executing that. I think Ed Carpenter did a little lap action. I know Jake and Jimmy were out there. So, great work in getting people out to that and just, you know, making use of such a cool venue outside of the month of May.
Yeah, that's the one thing that I underestimated. Listen, the eclipse was fun. It was cool. It was, you know, I mean, there are people off work or leaving work earlier. If nothing else, you're in your backyard. Maybe you're tailgating, whatever it may be, a little bit of family time. Like, it's like I viewed it through that prism, but I had no idea. I just got to be honest. I had no idea people cared that much about it and would travel that far. And IMS having over 50,000 people. What did you say? Was it 30-some-odd countries? Was it that many?
33, all 50 states.
That's staggering.
And 33 countries. Now, I did notice yesterday on his stroll around the neighborhood, maybe it was pre-eclipse, I did not see any eclipse sunglasses on one John Calipari or on Coach Cal's dog either.
Yeah, so it was one of the great stories on how it's petered out at the end there in Lexington at the University of Kentucky yesterday.
Mark, now, will you retweet this? Because this is video of the year.
So
such
you,
a
so
tough
if
look.
If you remember back in 2008, 2009, do you guys remember Billy Gillespie being chased down by, there's a reporter by the name of Alan Cutler in Lexington. He's still in Lexington. He retired a couple years ago.
Jay's cousin?
And, I don't think so. And he did what all TV people do. As soon as he got out of the business, KB, he grew his hair and he grew a beard because you're not allowed to do that when you're in local television, apparently. So Alan Cutler chased down Billy Gillespie, and Billy G act like he was on a phone. It was flip phone days. He act like he was talking to someone on the phone while trying to sprint and run away from the local media. So that has lived in lore.
Which
since,
I think we've all been there, maybe.
We've all faked a phone call here and there. So that's all the way back to like 2008, 2009. Cal gets hired, and it ends. Just think of the hubris. You're the most talked about story, quite frankly, in college basketball. And in Lexington, in the state of Kentucky, nothing in, or, you know, I'll even throw Indiana. It's this area of college basketball. You're the number one story, and you go for a stroll with your dog. Now, the dog
was. What was the stroller?
Okay, well, that's why I wanted to bring this up. People that have small dogs put their dogs in a stroller because the dogs can't, you know, they're tiny dogs with tiny legs. They can't walk a mile or a mile and a half. But Cal is walking with a dog in a stroller down, Kevin, one of the busiest roads in Lexington, Kentucky, full well knowing he is the number one conversation piece. And then this had to make you
be
cringe.
Like John Wilkes Booth standing
exactly,
on a highway or something.
He doesn't have AirPods, okay? You love AirPods. We both are guys that wear AirPods a lot. He didn't have AirPods. He's on speakerphone. So you got Cal on speakerphone being chased down the road by, I think it was WKYT there in Lexington. I guess that's going to be finalized today,
right?
We should get that announcement, but the pushing of the little dog
stroller—that's
next level. It
Purdue
really
fans
is.
Watch it; it'll make you smile. I don't know the validity on this at all, but somebody messaged me who claims they've got ties to the Valpo area. Okay, messaged me late last night and goes, apparently Scott Drew is getting announced tomorrow as Kentucky's head coach. $10 million a year.
Eight
for the NIL.
Well, he's number one on their list. I know, like, Nate Oates came out last night, and Hurley was asked about it last night. I never felt like Nate Oates. I thought that was coordinated a little bit. You had a local media member in Alabama say that Kentucky wanted Oates, and then like 30 minutes later, Nate Oates puts out that, you know, I'm very happy here. So I never thought that was ever anything. And as much as I love Dan Hurley, I think he would be a younger Calipari there. Why would you leave UConn?
Yeah, I mean, right now he's got it. He's got it as an absolute.
Yeah. I think that
wagon.
Was Cal. Yeah.
Is that what the young kids say? They're a wagon.
He's got the wagon going. I don't know why you would ever leave there. So I don't think that's going to happen. Scott Drew will have to say no, and then we go from there. As much as I would love to see Billy Donovan, you just have to wait so long for Billy Donovan. Even though they're in the play-in, you're talking about a couple weeks and then get the deal done. If they ever
wouldn't
get
Bulls
into
fans be
seven,
happy if
I don't think you have to wait. You could hire him today, and I think the Bulls would be just fine.
What if they move on from the play-in and they go play in a full series? Then you're waiting weeks down the road, and you get the portal going and high school kids and everything else. Coming up on the other end, we'll get back into the nuts and bolts of the game. Why did Purdue lose the national championship game and everything in between? We'll do it next 9 o'clock hour here on The Fan.
If you're talking about it,
the Purdue Boilermakers in one of the more head-scratching performances you'll see.
Just absolutely no-showed.
Absolute suffocation of the perimeter.
Body language by Purdue wasn't great.
We're talking about it.
I just cannot get over the lack of three-point attempts.
They allowed Edie to get his.
Fewest three-point attempts a Purdue team has had in 10 years.
Your home for Indy sports. 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Heat and cool places where ductwork won't fit using Mitsubishi Electric Ductless Mini Splits. You can even wrap them to match your decor.
Find out more at absolutecomfort.org.
Business. It's all the things that keep this world turning. And behind every one of these companies is a partner helping to keep it all moving. It's why the local flower shop and your favorite pizza joint, the startup and the stadium, hospitals and hotels, banks and restaurants nationwide, all choose the advanced network, cybersecurity solutions, and round-the-clock trusted partnership from Comcast Business, the company that powers more businesses than anyone else. Comcast Business, powering possibilities.
See why Comcast Business powers more small businesses than anyone else. Get started with fast speeds and advanced security for $49 a month for 12 months with a 2-year contract when you add one unlimited mobile line. Plus, ask how to get up to an $800 prepaid card with a qualifying gig bundle. Don't wait. Call to switch today. Ends 5/6/24. Restrictions apply. New customers only with 100 megabits per second internet and security edge. Eco bill and auto pay required. Equipment, taxes, and fees extra.
Your new Academy Sports and Outdoors store is now open in Greenwood. It's the sporting goods store that's all about fun, where you'll always find the gear you need to enjoy the outdoors, play the games you love, and create memories that will last forever. Find great brands at the best prices, in-store and online. Your next adventure starts at the new Academy Sports and Outdoors store, now open in Greenwood. Visit Academy and have fun out there.
Progressive presents Renters MVP's Most Valuable Possessions. Today's MVP, Joe Fallon's bedroom mini fridge. Sure, this pint-sized chiller's max capacity is 3 soda cans, but what it lacks in stature, it makes up in cooling strength. Each beverage a perfect 37 degrees every time. And the 2 feet Joe walks to get a drink? Priceless. That's why his mini fridge is today's MVP. Keep your most valuable possessions protected by bundling your renters and auto insurance with Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company affiliates and other insurers not available in all states.
From the DriveHubler.com studios, this is 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2 HD3, Indianapolis.
Padres, Dodgers, Sunday Night Baseball. The coverage begins at 6 on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
It's the wake-up call with KB and Andy on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
It's electric, and it feels probably 75-80% Purdue fans. But as Coach Painter always says, right, players got to give the crowd something to cheer about.
Lawyer, feed it. Edie, miss it. Oh!
Major highlight from Heidi.
Spin Newton, 7 to shoot. Double from Colvin. It leaves Caravan open.
Wow, what a find by Dilton.
Hey, Rav, you make a mistake, they make you pay.
Edie with a left hand, left it short, trying to score over Caravan on a left-handed hook shot. It's rebounded by Connecticut. We're down to 4:10 remaining in the game.
Oh, that's one. Zach definitely wants back.
Time quickly running out on the Boilermakers.
UConn fans on their feet behind head coach Dan Hurley. Shot clock down to four. Caravan, floated, clinging, exclamation point.
It's been that kind of night for Purdue's perimeter shooting. Braden Smith will get a cheer from the Purdue crowd, and so will Zach Edey, as Zach Edey gets a hero's applause as he goes to the bench area.
It is a UConn coronation. The Huskies make history. Back-to-back national champions.
The real difference ended up being their ability to offensive rebound in the second half.
Yeah, they just did a really good job guarding the three, and we got in the paint plenty of times. We just didn't convert on a lot of them.
You can say whatever you want about me. You can say however I play. You can say whatever, but you can never say that I didn't give it my 100% every single time I stepped on the floor.
We put ourselves in a great position now, and we took advantage of it. We just came up a little bit short to a great team, but I told our guys in the locker room, like, you know, when you have the most wins in school history, you're the first team to win back-to-back championships by multiple games since 1976, which was the last undefeated team in college basketball, and you get, you know, an eyelash away from winning it all, like that, you know, that's the standard.
I know I tried, it all fell apart. What it meant to be will eventually be a memory of a time I tried so.
How the hell did Seton Hall beat UConn by 15? That was my thought driving in. On this Tuesday morning, boy, I thought pretty much summed up very accurately from Matt Painter, Braden Smith, among others there. Thank you to the Purdue Radio Network. Turner, for those audio clips, Mark, we appreciate the various Purdue reentries here over the last week or so. Andy, it wasn't the turnovers.
On the game, that's it.
If you would have said to me yesterday at 9:04, Kevin, UConn is going to win by 15. They're going to be in pretty much full control throughout the whole second half, I would say. What was the turnover number? 15? 16?
And you would say the turnover number would be above 14 at least.
Right, right.
And probably 16, 17, something like that.
It was 9 for the game, which, again, for Purdue, that's very manageable. That's a Matt Painter sign on a dotted line. But the reality is 1 of 7 from three-point land is such a foreign number for Purdue. The makes, the attempts. It's the fewest attempts in 10 years by a Purdue basketball team. Obviously, the fewest makes of the season. UConn absolutely suffocated Purdue on the perimeter. And again, a shout out and a major credit to one of the craziest coaches, certainly in modern college basketball, and Dan Hurley. He said, "We will single team Zach Edey with Donovan Clingan." And my biggest key was you got to get Clingan in foul trouble. You couldn't get that second foul on him in the first half. I thought that game started to slip late first half. And then, you know, he battled a little bit of it in the second half. But at that point, the lead was swelling. And you weren't able to put any game pressure on him.
Yeah, you know, we've talked about it so much. And just to kind of reset for a new audience today or in the 9 o'clock hour, you know, I think for both of us, KB, you know, especially for me, UConn just, they made, you know, we've been waiting, and it's not even a Zach Edey thing, but, you know, you're waiting, you say, okay, who's going to have a bad game? And it just felt like UConn made this, and I said it at 7 o'clock, made it worst-case scenario so very much of the time last night for Purdue. I mean, outside of Edey and outside of Braden Smith, you had everyone else score just 11 points. You had 55 minutes of bench minutes if you're Matt Painter, and he went to the bench trying to find some sort of answer. You had 2 points in 55 minutes, and whether it be on the offensive side or the defensive side, it was worst-case scenario. It was Zach Edey can go get his, and it's not going to be enough to win. It's not going to be enough, and I think this is a huge point that you brought up. It's not going to be enough to get good looks, to get looks at all. And so if you're a Purdue fan, you're watching that game, and it became worst-case scenario that Edey, while having 37 points, wasn't in some stretches dominant, but it's also the fact that Edey wasn't enough. And then you start looking at the three-point line and the shots were not there. It's not even that the makes weren't there. It's not like they shot 2 for 25 or something like that. They shot 1 for 7. And so the makes weren't there, sure, but the attempts weren't there. And that is normal in your offense. And then you go to the rebounding edge. They lost the rebounding edge by 7, but the offensive boards, which has created second chance points, that wasn't there. We saw that earlier in the NC State game on Saturday night. And then finally, you know, you look at it, you didn't get to the free throw line nearly as much. You know, you wanted that to be, they shot 11 of 15, so they shot a very good percentage, much like the NC State game, but they didn't shoot enough of them. I'm not saying the officials swallowed their whistle in this Final Four, but Purdue, for whatever reason, in this game as well, they needed to have that number probably 8 to 10 more, 23, 25 free throw attempts. They didn't get that. And then, unfortunately, the Purdue guards, while being neutralized on the offensive side, they just could not stop UConn whatsoever. UConn got the shots that they wanted, whether it be a three or
at
the rim.
Too big, too skilled.
Just, you know, to me, you're watching that game, and outside the first, you know, 12, 14 minutes, Edie got tired, and it became worst-case scenario the final, you know, 25 minutes of that game.
Yeah, I think the offensive rebounding point is a good one to bring up, because you think about early in that NC State game. First off, NC State doubled Edie, you know, pretty much dug on him all game long. But for the most part, you know, when you look at those Fletcher Lawyer, Lance Jones threes early on Saturday night, if I'm not mistaken, I think both of them came after offensive rebounds. So that's when you naturally have breakdowns by defense. And now it isn't the same sort of, again, the suffocating defense on the perimeter there. You know, I said to you many times throughout the year, Andy, and just in general in describing Purdue, they are super reliable in two areas. One is they establish Edie, and kind of, I guess, a subset of that is that means they get to the foul line a whole lot. And then two is they're a terrific three-point shooting team. Again, second in the nation in three-point percentage throughout the season. Well, if you look at it last night, I mean, they, I would say, largely established Edie. The subset that there wasn't too reliable, though, foul line-wise. They shot 15 free throws. That's a small number for Purdue. They got into the bonus, you know, right around the midway point of each half. Like, that wasn't too much of the issue. They just couldn't take advantage of it off of that. And then again, the second reliable note, the three-point shooting. If they just shoot their averages, which, again, I know is kind of a hypothetical that seems crazy when you watch the entire 40-minute game play out. But, Andy, last night they were 1 of 7. Their averages from three on the year is an 8 of 20 game. 8 makes, 20 attempts.
And that really gets a guy like Fletcher Lawyer going. He's not a rebounder. He's not a defender. If he's out there, he's got to get looks and knock those down. Otherwise, he's a zero.
Sure,
yeah, I mean,
sure.
That's not against him. It's just that's what his specialty is getting and knocking down shots, and he never got any.
No, and I mean, the couple floaters he had didn't go in either. But, it, you know, if you go 8 of 20, if you hit your average, you know what? 8 times 3 is 24. 1 times 3 is 3. That's a 21-point difference from behind the arc for a team lost by. Like, you can just boil it all down to that. I mean, they could have withstood the offensive rebounding if they just get to their averages, but it's not like they passed up a bunch of great looks. That's probably my grand takeaway as well is, you know, at times last year in their tournament loss to Fairleigh Dickinson, I thought they looked scared from behind the arc. I thought they looked hesitant. I mean, they were the 290th or whatever they were, three-point shooting team in college basketball last year. So naturally you might have some of that fear factor moment, but that should not have been there last night. But again, so much credit to UConn for, if you even look at the 7 attempts Purdue had, they were absolutely challenged and deep. And I thought they made Edie really, really work. You know, you talked about Edie getting tired. You know, at one point he was 6 of 9, and I found myself just kind of jaw-dropping at Edie's first 10 or 12 minutes, like, damn, this is wildly impressive. But then part of me was like, is this sustainable for 40 minutes? Like, Klingon is at least making him catch it, whatever, 12 feet away from the basket, or he's making him work a little bit, and we're just so used to Edie being a machine, a 40-minute machine, where he just outlasts, you know, multiple guys fouling out.
He catches the ball, he puts that up over his shoulder, and he hits a little turnaround. Yeah. It's easy. Yeah, but that wasn't the case.
But again, Klingon, I thought, just made it tough for him and kind of wore him down, and eventually you saw it. I think at one point, Edie had missed six or seven in a row. He had a travel. He airballed a free throw out of a timeout. Just stuff we're just not used to seeing from him at all. And I thought it all changed right there when he had that travel. With about 6 or 7 minutes to go in the first half, Caleb first comes in, Klingon goes and one, Purdue gets an offensive foul at the other end, and now it's snowballed. Now it's, and you know, snowballing to five doesn't seem like a lot, but in such a back-and-forth game early on, I felt like UConn just needed a little bit of a crack of the door. Purdue provided that, and next thing you know, UConn was, you know, living.
Yeah, I would say there's two things that listen, there's more than two. All these things that we're talking about, you're going to look back if you're Matt Painter and his coaching staff and the players, and you're going to be bothered by it. I would say the way, you know, coaches always talk about the way you end a half and then the way you start the second half. And if you look at last night, you're talking about, now that was a few minutes before the end of the half, but what you're talking about is the latter parts of the first half. You know, they get down six, which isn't a big deal, but then you got to come back in the second half and you got to do something with it. And immediately you get a foul on Kling and you're thinking, okay, this is good, right? This is the Purdue formula, is now let's get one of their bigs in foul trouble. And you know that no one else is going to be able to guard Edie. And if you can get Klingon out of the game, what then? Then they're going to double. Then they're going to dig. Then they're going to send extra defenders at Edie. And that would open up Fletcher Lawyer and Lance Jones and Brain Smith and everybody else. But, you know, they get the Edie miss layup, they get an Edie miss dunk, and in the middle, Tristan Newton hits a three, and now you don't end the first half as well as you would like. It's a six-point game, and you're thinking, okay, let's – and that, I would say the way they came out in the second half was
surprising.
And
Edie missed a couple shots at the rim.
Giving the Matt Painter so good at that sort of thing, right, out of timeouts, out of the half, and they come out, they're down nine, and then you mentioned it's snowball. Then the other thing, and we've mentioned this, but we haven't directly mentioned this. And it's a staggering stat from last night. Braden Smith is the only player on Purdue's team that had an assist.
Yep.
And he had eight of them. And again, Braden Smith, I have said it today three or four times. Braden Smith had a fine game. He had a nice bounce back game, I think, for the most part. If he hit a couple of those elbow jumpers, I would probably feel even better about his game. But Braden Smith was the quarterback who consistently had the defensive lineman in his face. You know, in his face, hitting him after the play, at his feet. He never had a clean pocket. That was Braden Smith. But the fact that, like, I would, like, if I'm Matt Painter, they probably have the printouts on analytics. How many, can you think of a game where one player
had
an assist, especially for this team?
That's a historical number.
Again, he had eight assists. Nobody else had an assist. Not even Zach Edey catches, kicks it out, Lance Jones hits a three. Not one of those the entire game. It's unbelievable.
And again, that is so much of how their offense can play. I mean, when Edey would kick it out, it was immediately on the catch. UConn defenders there. You swing it around the horn. Hey, extra pass, extra pass. Like, nothing got to clean looks. I mean, Miles Colvin tied for the game-high lead in three-point attempts for Purdue. I mean, you want to talk about a recipe that isn't going to lead to a win, that's it. And if you just look at the numbers, Lawyer averages just under 4 three-point attempts a game. He didn't shoot his first one until 5 minutes to go in the game. Lance Jones averages nearly 6 three-point attempts. We've watched Lance Jones this year.
Oh, I know.
Andy, he'll shoot it from Attica.
A couple times.
Shoot it from Crawfordsville.
And they maybe needed that.
His first one is 3 minutes to go in the game, his first attempt, his only attempt.
Yeah.
And it gets blocked.
Yeah.
And then if you look at Braden, you know, it's that one fadeaway in the first half. He only takes two. You know, Mason Gillis, they ran that set for him early in the second half, and it's an air ball. It's just, you know, and Gillis usually shooting, you know, three a game. You know, just a massive credit to Dan Hurley and their execution of saying, when Klingon is on the floor, we are not going to help. We'll live with the twos. We think we can defend without fouling, and we'll take away the three-point line. And it was a strategy that was challenged significantly in the first 10 minutes. Dan Hurley said it to Tracy Wolfson. Right now, like, we are worried about what he's doing, and we're going to have to mix it up. I mean, he said those exact words to Tracy Wolfson and then never really mixed it up. And I thought the other big thing in the first half was, if you just could have got Kling in that second foul, what would that have done? Because we saw the backup. The backup couldn't. I mean, he had 5 fouls in 5 minutes. So, you know, if you could have gotten the second on him and forced UConn to double a little bit more, you know, maybe you do find a little bit more early success in general. Because Klingon finished the game with 4 fouls. I mean, but not getting that second one on him was I thought, a huge issue.
Yeah, you know, I want to take this a different way. So earlier in the show, I asked the question, and I'll ask it here, but I want to look at more of the Purdue fan and kind of projecting what they're thinking. You know, UConn is so now, with the win last night and what they did this season and last season, KB, they are historically great. They will be remembered historically great. People in 10, 15, 20, 25 years, you know, our kids, hopefully our grandkids, you know, will be talking about the great teams, the great eras, the great runs in college basketball. And UConn has been that, whether you want to go back to 1999 or you want to look at even recently.
Is that hyperbole
by me?
Because I think it's the best run of my life.
No,
I think it's the best 2-year run, born in 89. I think it's the best 2-year run of my life.
No, I mean, I can go back to 99, or I can do what you're saying in the last 2 years, and I know they had some lean years. It checks out. I mean, UConn is a blue blood. They're a powerhouse. They have moved past. I mean, I know Indiana fans don't want to hear, but they moved past, in my mind, some historic programs. UConn has moved past Indiana and Louisville and some of these different programs.
I think I already passed that.
Well,
you,
I mean,
we really
but you know what I'm saying. I mean, last night just concretes it even more that, you know, if I'm Matt Painter, two things. Number one, if I'm Matt Painter, you know, you look at this year, the evaluation of this season, we've talked about it. They challenge themselves in the non-con, and they win the Big Ten by, what was it, 3 games in the regular season. And then they go and they make this run by winning 5 games and getting to the national title game. So, you know, do you look at it? You know, last year I thought they had to do some soul searching. Now I'm interested with so many new pieces, and Edie's going to be obviously off to the NBA. How Matt Painter views the loss last night of, is there soul searching that needs to be done? Is there somebody who has got a lot of minutes who may get Mason Gillis and might be coming off the bench? Like, I am interested in how he views his team through the prism of, hey guys, we just lost to this historically great UConn team, which ended up being a bad matchup. And then, you know, I know it's heartbreaking, frustrating. What is it for the Purdue fan, you know, who, you didn't lose because of a single call. You didn't lose because some BS happened and there was something fluky. There's really not much to complain about. You lost, and UConn was just the better team. You leave being like, we gave it our all, but UConn was just dominant. I don't know if that makes the Purdue fan feel better or worse today, because you don't know when you're going to be back. I mean, that's the whole narrative of this team making the Final Four, is you had to wait more than 4 decades to finally get back.
Yeah, I guess there's a little bit of Colt Patriot feel to it of just, damn, like they are so good. And you can acknowledge that, but at the same time, I think you can be incredibly bummed by these opportunities. Don't grow on trees. And while I do think that Matt Painter is going to get Purdue into the month of April on several more occasions throughout his coaching tenure, like, betting odds would probably say that's at best a coin flip chance right now. And, you know, to be fair to Purdue, they had a lot break their way this year. I mean, let's just be totally honest. And that's not something we typically say about Purdue. But for the first time in school history, they had the same starting five the entire year. I mean, what, Gillis maybe missed a game, if I'm imagining correctly, like back in the non, I can't, I mean, you know, Braden obviously got banged up, but still, it's not like you had guys out for, you know, any significant stretch whatsoever. You didn't have the Jamal Shedd turn of an ankle. Andy, your path was, you know, Indy and Detroit. I mean, you can't ask for a better path to the Final Four.
You got NC State in the national semifinal.
Yeah.
You know, sorry.
And I think their region still offered some roadblocks. I don't want to act like Purdue just had a cakewalk. I just mean where they were slotted. You know, Indianapolis and Detroit, that's exactly what you would want from a driving standpoint for your fan base. We pretty much knew in December that's the path that they would be heading on. It's not always that sort of path. Now, granted, you can still make it in different ways. I mean, hell, UConn was, what, a 4 seed last year? And, you know, they obviously got to the championship game. And Purdue has, you know, been on the brink of a Final Four without a dominant post player. Now, Carson Edwards was historic, and Ryan Klein certainly had the game of a lifetime. But still, you know, Purdue has been able to do it without this dominant of a post player. But still, I just – I keep on coming back to these opportunities don't grow on trees. And in no way do I expect Purdue's next 5 to 10 years look how it did for Indiana post 2002 championship game run. But because they are the two Big Ten prominent dominant programs from a notoriety standpoint in our state, I mean, look at Indiana since that 02 championship game.
There's just too much stability.
They haven't
with
even
Matt Painter.
Got to an Elite Eight. That's where you do. I mean, it's Alabama's first ever trip to the Final Four. NC State, you know, whatever. Imagine saying to that fan base in 83, you're not going to get there for this amount of time. It is not a given. Granted, I do think Purdue is pretty well equipped to sustain some level. I mean, 7 straight years as a top four seed.
Yeah.
I mean, that's damn impressive.
Yeah, like, I'm not saying they win the Big Ten next year, but if they fell off and they were, 15 and 16 next year, towards the bottom third quadrant, if you will, of the Big Ten, I would be stunned.
Like, if I was
There's
a betting
solid
man,
stuff there.
I would say the 7 straight years as a top four seed goes to an eighth year. Now, I don't think there'll be a 1 or a 2 necessarily. Obviously, it's April 9th. We know how college basketball operates.
I think it'll be close.
We don't even have a head coach at Kentucky, and the portal is probably just getting started, frankly. So I need to see how some of this plays out. But right now, I think Purdue looks like on paper they could have, a top 15-ish type team next season.
I would say this as well. When we talk about, and some fan bases are different with this, when we talk about, you don't know when you're going to be back. Matt Painter, after the game, even talked about it. He said, hey, we did everything we could. We knew this was going to be an opportunity for us, and we left it all out there, and we took this opportunity. We messed up last year, and we ended up in the national title game this year. I don't believe – it's easy for me to say. I don't believe the Purdue fan took this for granted at all. Maybe some of the winning in the regular season the last few years, I think you take for granted a little bit, just because, and that might not even be for granted. That's just having the confidence that your team is going to get it done. Yeah, I don't think they did. I don't think they took anything for granted. The fan base understanding that it's not easy to get back to the Final Four. That was the entire narrative around this team. I wanted to ask you this as well. We'll get to the check down here in just a second. What do we foresee Dan Hurley being in the big picture? Because he's the hottest coach right now, but he's also, and I'll go back to this, he's not on ESPN. So he's not going to get the ESPN love, and he's not going to be thrown in our face. I mean, we're going to hear more of Duke Carolina or John Shire than we're going to hear about Dan Hurley because his games aren't on ESPN. How are we going to start talking? In other words, I know Patino's still here, but, he's at St. John's. Cal is on the back end of his career. You look at Roy Williams has left. Coach K has left. Jay Wright has left. Dan Hurley is, he is great, and he's not the personality of a guy like Scott Drew. He's not a personality of even a Tom Izzo. I mean, Dan Hurley is theatrics on the sideline and the cockiness and some of the things he says. He's very Jersey guy.
Oh, he's very, through and through.
He's very man from New Jersey.
And he'll let you know it.
And he'll let and listen, they're going to be good. It's not like you expect them to fall off, the cliff as well. And if I even nitpicked, I could say – their conference maybe was overrated. What, 3 teams make it from the Big East to the tournament this year? What do you think our conversation on Hurley now is going to be?
Well, I would argue they're underrated, the Big East. I think they should have got more teams
in.
Well, I mean,
you're probably not wrong. Seton Hall did a nice job
for themselves in the NIT. I think Bob Hurley. I think Dan Hurley is the next college basketball villain.
Yeah.
And
I think
if you are a villain
–
it means you're good.
Yeah.
It means you're damn good. It means we're jealous of you.
Yeah.
It means we want to be you.
Bob Knight had some of that.
Sure.
Calipari had
Belichick,
some of that. You know, from 2010 to 2015.
Go to other sports.
Sure.
Yeah. I mean, and no Purdue fan wants to hear it, and they certainly don't want to hear it after watching him last night. They probably yelled tech at, Dan Hurley about 19 times or get off the floor at him another 27 times.
Wow. Yeah.
But, Andy, he is so freaking entertaining. And for college basketball – that's kind of a bit up in the air, just on like what it's going to look like for the next 5 to 10 years. A villain on the East Coast with the Jersey, attitude. That's a dream. Like, I love golf. golf needs villains, you know? Like,
that's not the Live Tour.
Right. Well, like, if golf had anything that sniffed a villain, right, they went to Live. Like, some of those guys on Live,
fair
you
point.
Would label that. I say this about IndyCar. Like, IndyCar, embrace the villain. Yeah. Embrace the rivalry. Well, embrace the villain.
I've asked that. Who's the villain nature. In IndyCar? And you go, oh, yeah, there's really not one.
Right.
Like, come
so,
on.
Like, again, like, you need that. And Hurley wants it. He wants it.
He wants
and,
the smoke.
He, frankly, deserves it. This stat here from Pat Forty is absolutely wild to me. So, we mentioned earlier, UConn, 12 straight tournament wins. They covered all 12 of those. They won all of them by at least 13. These back-to-back tournament runs. And in this year's tourney, of the 240 minutes that UConn played, they trailed for only 6 minutes and 22 seconds. Pat Forty takes it a step further. He goes, most impressive stat I found from UConn's 2-year run in the tourney. It has trailed in the second half of those 12 games for a total of 53 seconds. The first 15 seconds against Iona last year in round one, which I will never forget because I had UConn in the title game last year, and I go, oh my gosh, are they going to lose Iona? And then in the second round, they trailed for 38 seconds against St. Mary's. So that means starting with last year's Sweet 16, Elite Eight, Final Four national title, this year from round one all the way through the national title.
It's unbelievable.
Andy, they didn't trail in the final 10 minutes of any game.
It's unbelievable. It really is. You mentioned New England Patriots. That's probably, is that the best example? It probably
yeah, and
is.
I would say the only reason it won't get that attention is just because it is Connecticut. Like, if it was Kentucky or Duke or that, we would hear it constantly.
Yeah.
And, you know, for those that, like, watch ESPN, the fact that ESPN doesn't air the Big East games probably plays a little bit into that as well. But he's an absolute villain.
I mean, the dude literally two-handed shoved one of his players to go further on the court last night with, like, 4 minutes to go in the game.
I will agree with Purdue fans. He should have been reprimanded in the first half about being on the floor. He was on the floor several times.
One of my buddy group texts said Hurley is crazy enough to get ejected from the national title game
while leading by 17.
And I sat there and read the text. And I'm like, he's right. Like, if there is any coach right now in college basketball that could go to the shower early and have Bill Murray's son have to take over the rest of the way, it is Dan Hurley. So I totally get why Purdue fans want to hate him right now and probably should hate him right now. But damn, is that villain good for college basketball?
It's different crazy, but at some point we do need UConn and Dan Hurley to face off against Iowa and Fran McCaffrey. I mean, at some point we do need that. Put it on FS1.
Well,
no problem with it.
I'm sorry I haven't been up to date with Arizona State basketball. Where's his brother? Is his brother still coaching?
Yeah.
Is he still at Arizona State?
I think he's gone from Arizona State, right? I thought he was gone. I guess I should know that.
No, he's
still there. He's
so
there.
Greg Lansing, Indiana State, is with him on staff. The very few times I've watched Arizona State over the last 6 to 8 years, you don't need to watch the game for more than 2 minutes before you realize a Hurley brother's coaching. We just need that matchup on an annual basis.
Yeah, Bobby has, unfortunately for Bobby Hurley, he has a theatrics, but he hasn't won, and he's on the he's Pac-12 basketball.
Right.
You know.
Well now he's what?
At least
Big 12 basketball?
Yeah, at least he used to be Pac-12 basketball.
We are going to give away a Cluster Truck gift card coming up on the pop quiz. So, again, they are giving, on their menu this week, pimento cheese sandwiches for the Masters. Brought some in earlier. Absolutely outstanding. So, $25 gift card coming up in a few for the pop quiz. Before that, let's head to a morning checkdown.
The morning checkdown.
Omaha!
On 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Yeah, let's get your morning check down popping with the action last night, national championship game there in Phoenix, 75-60. That is your final. UConn Huskies go back-to-back. They finish their season at 37-3. Purdue losers there, 34-5 on their season. And like we've talked about basically all morning, Connecticut so great rebounding the ball and defensively. They were just superb. Purdue head coach Matt Painter post-game agreed.
In a game like this, we had to be able to rebound defensively better,
and then we had to have something balance that out, and that was her threes, and they just stayed home with us. They did a really good job defensively. You know, they get a lot of credit, and Donovan Klingon's a very good defensive player, but we've played against athletes, you know, and played against some really good defensive guys this year and in the tournament, but not the collection of defensive players like UConn has. You know, we'd play against somebody and they'd have a lockdown defender. These guys are bringing lockdown defenders off the bench.
Yeah, so again, 75-60, your final there. Let's get to some Zach Edey sound. Played the big guy, played 39 minutes in the game, 37 points, 10 rebounds in the effort, in the loss. Post-game, he was asked about his legacy. Here's what Edey had to say.
I don't think that's kind of for Purdue to decide. I'm not going to tell my own legacy, but I think for me, the big thing is you can say whatever you want about me. You can say however I play. You can say whatever, but you can never say that I didn't give it my 100% every single time I stepped on the floor, every single time I went in practice, and that's what I always hang my hat on. I came in, and I never didn't give it 100%.
Most points for a runner-up in a national title game, 37 last night. For Zach Edey, Tristan Newton for the second straight year is the most outstanding player. All right, Pacers and Raptors tonight north of the border. Pacers favored. You said it's climbed to 11?
I saw it here.
It was 10 this morning.
ESPN Bet had it. Okay, it's now 12.5 on ESPN Bet. It was 11.5 the last time we did the check down.
Good Lord.
I would guess that's the biggest road favorite the Pacers have been all season. We know no Scottie Barnes. We know no Emmanuel Quickly. They've got a couple others that are questionable. Grady Dick had a nice game against the Pacers a few weeks ago. He was listed as questionable. So, yes, the Raptors, after losing 14 straight, have won two in a row, but this is going to be a pretty banged-up Raptors bunch. And, again, the Pacers very much in play to move up in the standings. They win two of these last three. They will secure a spot in a seven-game first-round series, but they could actually still get home court. So a lot to play for. We had Rick Carlisle on earlier, outstanding per usual, if you want to check that out on the pod.
I'm looking at an updated sportsbook, 13.
Wow. Are the Raptors playing Drake tonight?
Yeah, but I mean, you got to think of it. If they don't have, Jacob Poeltl, and they don't have Scottie Barnes, Grady Dick, and they don't have Emmanuel Quickly, those are four of their top six guys, right? It's just R.J. Barrett. Who's the other guy? Bruce Brown? Are those the two that I'm missing that are in the top part of their rotation? And I haven't followed Brown since he obviously left here.
Is it bad I might take the points? Is that a bad look on me?
Well, I mean, the Pacers have certainly given you reason to do that this season, but
if this were a five and if this spread were six and a half, Mark, and just about maybe Jacob Poeltl is the only one who's out, I would say you taking the points is absolutely the right play. I just don't know who's going to be left on the Raptors after these guys are gone.
I don't know.
Bruce Brown.
The numbers are climbing like they're tonight. They have the water boys out there.
I have no idea. Quickly, Major League Baseball. Reds winners 10-8 yesterday over Milwaukee. So we say a very big we're sorry to Joel A. Erickson. Your boy Ellie De La Cruz hit two home runs, once inside the park. KB, one 450 feet.
Don't look now, but here come the Red Legs.
Thank you, Mark. Cardinals losers 5-3. Then Mark Dighton's poor Chicago Cubs got up 8-0 on the road in San Diego. They end up losing 9-8. Tatis set a two-run homer late in that one to end things there. So there's your Major League Baseball scoreboard update.
Gift card time?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's take a break. On the other side, 239-1070. Load them up. You'll have a chance to win the oil change on the pop quiz. Also giving away a $25 gift card to Cluster Truck. 239-1070. We'll do it next year on The Fan.
Hey, it's JMV, and this is your last chance.
down. Have you studied? Can you handle the pressure? Sharpen your pencils. It's time for the Pop Quiz with KB and Andy. Brought to you by Jiffy Lube, Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
I think I'm blaming Purdue's loss in the Eclipse.
Yeah, that's not a bad idea. You could do that.
Too much Purdue astronaut attention towards that.
You know what it was? It was because our guy Adam Shank didn't get a private jet to Phoenix and back. It was a bad mojo was put out last weekend.
I mean, I think he's doing today.
Purdue dignitaries over at IMS. I'm like, oh, he got business in Phoenix, people.
Well, yeah. There were dignitaries?
I saw a Purdue Pete. How many Purdue Petes are there?
Well, seven. Seven.
Most intimidating
like
mascot.
I would imagine
that or the Providence
what
Friar.
The Friar's a good one. What was the percentage of totality, Scotty? Do you know out in Phoenix? Was it like 60% of the sun was swallowed up, or 75%?
Judging by the map, they weren't anywhere close to the.
No.
Did I hear correctly? Indianapolis International, or I guess it would have been Austin and Indianapolis International, had a flight that took off and would have been in the totality path for, like, I think a vast majority of the flight, if not all of it.
That would have been pretty wild.
So remember, like, that line that kind of started in Texas and kind of cut through, obviously, the middle part and through Indy and then all the way up into the northeast part of the United States? I'm pretty sure there was a flight that's what they offered.
That's
think
awesome.
You'd start seeing pictures of that if you were on that flight, you'd be taking pictures.
But, yeah, my wife had a meeting over the airport yesterday morning. She was saying that was
you would want to be a part of, KB, or not? I could see you saying, you know, there's just too much going on there to worry about the eclipse, and it might mess with some of the controls or something like that.
I mean, I wouldn't be, like, fearful of, like, the plane going down necessarily. Okay. That's just not my cup of tea.
All right.
Yeah. Fine. Again, I compare the eclipse yesterday to double bubble gum. Tremendous 5 minutes. There are other activities that you could label that. We'll keep it PG, though. So blue and yellow wrapper. We all have been there. Double bubble gum.
By 9:40, the kids are in school anyway. Are they back to school, Mark?
Yes,
kids
today's
finally?
The first day.
It's been 3
Hallelujah.
Weeks.
Lafayette school's 2-hour delays.
My daughter was very confused when I was like, hey, start getting to bed. Why? You got school tomorrow. No, I don't. Yes, you do. Thank God spring break is over.
All right, so we are giving away a Cluster Truck gift card, $25. Again, the fan. That is our promo code always for Cluster Truck, as they've got free delivery and a special pimento cheese sandwich here for Masters Week. Andy Sweeney, a number 1-8.
Oh, goodness. What did Purdue end up losing this season? Just 4 games when it's all said and done?
If you include the Big Ten tournament.
34-5. So let's do caller number 5.
Scott.
No, is this Scott from yesterday?
I don't know. Let's find out. If it is, we'll have to go elsewhere.
You know, I wasn't listening yesterday. It wasn't me.
Oh. Okay, we got double Scotts. Hey, Scott, you a Purdue fan?
No, I went to Louisville, so I've been living symbiotically with Purdue since Louisville's been such a terrible school here the last 2 years with Kenny Payne.
What do you think of Pat Kelsey getting the nod there? But more importantly, what do you think of Calipari leaving?
I mean, he wasn't my first choice, but I loved his introductory press conference. So, you know, I hope for the best. Like I said, anything's better than Kenny Payne.
No kidding.
Yeah, I think it's hilarious that Calipari left. I think he definitely wanted out. And, I mean, I think Arkansas, with all their NIL money, they're going to be pretty good with him.
We need a Pat Kelsey-Dan Hurley rivalry. They're both pretty crazy on the sidelines.
Yeah, I haven't seen Kelsey enough to know, but he's got to have – there's something about being the big-mouth Jersey Northeastern guy. I don't even think Pat Kelsey can be that crazy. Ganny, I don't know. I guess we'll find out.
Scott, hope you do better than your cards have done here in recent years. Andy Sweeney, go ahead with number 1.
All right, Scott, let's get a winner. You already got a gift card. Let's get that oil change. Question number 1. UConn beat Purdue last night. We know 75-60 in the championship game. Zach Edey led all scorers with 37 points and 10 rebounds. Named the only other Boiler to reach double digits in points. Was it Fletcher Lawyer, Lance Jones, Trey Kaufman Wren, or Braden Smith?
Braden Smith.
Scott, who's your favorite Louisville player of all time?
Russ Smith. Do you remember him?
Oh, sure.
I could tell by Scott, you sound like a little bit of a younger guy. You had to go Russ Smith.
I was at that Notre Dame-Louisville 5 overtime game, Scott, back in the day.
Nice. Yeah.
Yeah,
I was at Louisville when that game took place. I was there during the 2013 championship team.
Scott,
there you go.
Scott, in Louisville, you know where I watched that game? The Sports and Social Club.
Oh, yeah, on 4th Street, yep.
That's where I watched. That's an odd place. Go ahead.
Are there more stories?
Well,
than,
no, I just
okay.
We basically had a lot of free drinks.
I wasn't sure what the social aspect of that club meant. All right, Scott, number two here. UConn men and women, their basketball teams combined 17-1 in history for national championship games. Named the only school to knock off the Huskies in an NCAA title game. South Carolina, Notre Dame, Duke, or Louisville?
I think it was South Carolina on the buzzer beater.
Scott, you sound like a smart dude.
He's got it going, man. He's got it going. Question number three. UCLA won 10 NCAA men's tournament championships in a 12-season period between 1964 and 1975. Name one of the two teams other than UCLA that won the NCAA men's tournament between 1964 and 1975. There's two of them.
Scott?
I'll go Kansas.
Quiet as Louisville basketball has been here lately.
It's a tough question.
Number four, Scott, which Major League Baseball team currently has the worst record? Is it the Athletics, the White Sox, the Marlins, or the Nationals?
The Marlins have been getting crushed lately, so I'll go with the Marlins.
Last question. Question number five. 3 years ago today, Joe Musgrove threw the first no-hitter in San Diego Padres history as the Padres became the last of the current 30 MLB teams to finally record a no-no. Which MLB team is currently experiencing the longest no-hitter drought? Interesting. Is it the Atlanta Braves, the Cleveland Guardians / Indians, the Toronto Blue Jays, or the Kansas City Royals?
The Royals.
All right, not a bad effort
good job,
there
Scott.
From Scott. Yeah. Scott, are you from Louisville, or where'd you go to high school?
No, I went to Carmel High School. I live in Westfield.
Oh, nice. C-C-C-A-R-M-M-M-A-L-C-A-R-M-A-L. Carmel. Brayden Smith, 12 points last night.
That
the only other.
Correct.
Speaking of Westfield. No. The
good
only
job.
Boiler to reach double-digit points. That one was pretty easy. He got the South Carolina right, number two.
A-D-D-A-I, a die.
I love busting that one out every once in a while.
Is that for Joseph Adai?
Joseph Adai, Colts legend.
Kevin has a lot of chants on the history of the show.
You're a chanter.
I am a chanter, yes. Didn't hear a lot of Let's Go Boilers last night in the building. The Marlins at 1-10.
Yeah. Boy, they're bad.
3-5, the two slip-ups, is that right?
Yeah, number three, again, who won an NCAA tournament championship between 64 and 75, given the UCLA won seemingly all of them? Texas Western or NC State? That was your answer there.
You blew it!
And then the Padres, I remember this, the Padres, Joe Musgrove, finally got a no-hitter 3 years ago today. That means everyone, all 30 MLB teams, have recorded a no-no. Which team is experiencing the longest no-hitter drought? That would be the Cleveland Indians / Guardians. Their last one was by Len Barker in May of 1981. So there you go. The Guardians, it's been since 1981.
I've got some thank yous here to round things out on this Tuesday morning. Again, Scott getting that Cluster Truck gift card right now. We'll do that all week long. Here on the Pop Quiz.
Yeah, we'll take a break on the other end. KB has his thank yous, our final thoughts on the Purdue game. One final time here, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Indy's biggest party is back.
It's the Wake Up Call with KB and Andy on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
And to round it out on this national title recap, I do want to make sure, really a sincere thank you. We had the goal and the objective at the start of this tournament run for Purdue was to bring you a Purdue guest every day throughout the tournament run. So a ton of people to thank. Mark, Andy, thank you guys for helping and thinking of people. And I feel like the list is covered. I hope I'm not forgetting anybody. But Ryan Klein, Konzo Martin, Bruce Weber, Austin Parkinson, Rafael Davis, Dakota Mathias, Adam Schenck, Rob Blackman, Bobby Riddell, Brian Newbert, Sam King, Carson Cunningham, and of course, how could we forget the one and only 92-year-old Bill Albert. I was thinking of Bill last night.
I wrote it on our Google document that I'm hurting over. Sorry, do I have something going on? My bad. I was hurting over Bill Albert. 94 years old, man.
Gosh, he was the one I was thinking about late last night.
In fact, I'm hurting that you brought him up because I remembered in the 7 o'clock hour, and then I forgot about it. I'm hurting. Poor Bill Albert.
But seriously, thank you to all those Purdue guests. I hope Purdue fans, I know we're not the flagship, but to me, the story deserved the attention that I hope that we gave it here throughout the run. It was a hell of a season.
It was a great run, yeah.
I think, objectively, it's the best season a team from the state of Indiana has had, I guess, in my lifetime, right? I mean, I don't know. I mean, obviously, IU, a great run in 02, but, you know, even then, they were the 5 seed. Butler, certainly, you know, crazy runs, but, again, not the regular season sort of success. So, hell of a ride, and unfortunately, a dud of a finish.
Yeah, I mean, my thing on them is, you know, they had all the pressure of the basketball world, and they came back, and they won the Big Ten.
The utter humiliation.
They made the Final Four. I mean, I know they didn't win the national championship, but they had to make the Final Four, and they did. So that's it for us. We'll be back at it at 7 o'clock tomorrow. JMV, Jake, and Jimmy coming up. Have a good day here on The Fan. If you're